longest running rivalry in major college football is Minnesota and Wisconsin. Not to hoist a trophy, but to swing the axe. The handle has the score of every game the Gophers and Badgers have played. In 97, with Ron Dayne.
For the win.
In 03, with a last second field goal.
Paul Bunyan's axe goes to Minnesota.
In 05.
Oh, he fumbled it.
With a last minute blocked punt.
It's blocked! Unbelievably!
Wisconsin's won the last nine. Now, will the Gophers have a score to settle? Can the Badgers keep hold of Paul Bunyan's pride? Bunyan's axe has never been bigger. Chop that.
Welcome to ESPN College Football, presented by Cars.com. The axe began the journey today at the Badgers Hotel this morning and has arrived at TCF Bank Stadium on the Minnesota campus. It was brought on the field for a pregame ceremony, but will now stay warm in the Wisconsin locker room until it's brought onto the field late in the game. A pair of 8-2 football teams battle for the axe on a bitter cold late November Saturday as Wisconsin meets Minnesota again. The Gophers, one of the nation's surprise teams and one of college football's best stories, considering its unique coaching situation with Jerry Kill coaching in a limited role from the press box as he continues to treat and manage epilepsy. Tracy Clays will serve as acting head coach for the sixth straight game. Hi, everybody. Alongside Brian Greasy, I'm Dave Pasch. Minnesota has won four in a row in conference play for the first time in 40 years. They have an 8-win season going. That's the first time that's happened in a decade. What's been the difference with this Gopher team in 2013, Brian?
You know, I think you have to start with Jerry Kill and the job that Tracy Clays has done. They've done an outstanding job at motivating this team week in and week out, getting them ready to play. And in the last 4 weeks, it's really been the ground game. They've averaged over 220 yards on the ground, beaten teams like Nebraska and Penn State. They're going to need that ground game if they're going to beat Wisconsin the game today.
All right, for more on the game day operations today, let's check in down on the field with Tom Luganville.
Well, don't kid yourself. Jerry Kill is involved. In fact, he was down here in pregame warm-up, big smile on his face, a lot of motivation, a lot of leadership. He's involved, but the two big areas that he's changed his the way he's gone about his job is delegation of authority and management of his time. Spoke with the team before the game, before heading up to the press box. He'll be involved in the play-in, play-out mode of operation of this game today.
All right, now on the other side, Tom, you got a Wisconsin team that's also 8-2, and the Badgers still with a chance at a BCS at-large bid. They have a new coaching staff, but it's still Wisconsin football.
It's still ground and pound, but, man, they've added the element that Melvin Gordon brings on the outside with the jet sweep, James White on the inside running. These are the only two backs in college football that both have over 1,000 yards on one team. They have been outstanding as a team, averaging over 7 yards a rush. That leads college football. And you're going to see a heavy dose of them again in this game.
123rd meeting dating back to 1890. Wisconsin goes for its 10th straight win in the series and another year with Paul Bunyan's axe. Welcome back to Minneapolis, Wisconsin, and Minnesota squaring off at TCF Bank Stadium, which opened in 2009. So we don't have a ton of games to go by, but it's still the coldest kickoff temperature for this stadium. But for Wisconsin, they've been in worse weather. You know, they played outdoors for 100 years, and this is matching the third coldest game the Badgers have ever played in. The coldest was in 1964 in Madison when it was 11 degrees at kickoff. But the wind chill is 3 degrees, and it's going to get worse when the sun goes down in the second half. Wisconsin won the toss and deferred to the second half, so Minnesota will receive the opening kickoff. And here is Marcus Jones, a dangerous kick returner. He's got a kick return for a touchdown this year, but well covered and dropped at the 23-yard line. Now Brian talked about the difference with Minnesota in our open, and it's the rushing over the last four games, Brian.
Yeah, we talked with offensive coordinator Matt Limegrove at last night. He talked about the Iowa game really being the pivotal game for Minnesota. They tried to run their power offense, and they just couldn't match up with that physical defensive line for Iowa. So they've implemented the jet sweep element after that game, and it's been very successful. rush have been a big reason why they've had the success running the football that they've had the last four games.
The quarterback is Philip Nelson, a sophomore, and they're going to run him on first down. And he's across the 25 and pushed out at the 28, a 5-yard gain. Philip Nelson's dad, Pat, played at Wisconsin, and Philip was recruited by the Badgers but chose the Gophers.
And you see on the first snap, there's the jet sweep. They're not always going to hand it off on the outside. They're going to run the inside zone. They're going to run the belly on the inside, and then the quarterback, Philip Nelson, very good running with the football. But that jet sweep, as you watch the rest of the game today, we're going to talk about how that influences the defense, even if they don't hand the football off.
David Cobb in the backfield, averaging 94 yards per game. And they hand it to Cobb, faking that sweep. And Chris Borland, Wisconsin's leading tackler, takes him to the ground after a minimal gain. It'll bring up third down.
And third down's really where Philip Nelson has been better as the season has gone along. You see he's got 10 touchdowns in the last four games. He's been more efficient. You know, he finally got the starting job for Mitch Leidner, and the team has really responded to him. He's more confident throwing the football, and Matt Limegrower trusts him in situations like this on third down to throw the football.
Brian, today he's without his best receiver, Derek Engel, injured a knee in practice and will not play today. We'll see who he targets here on third down and four. That's if they throw the ball. And they will. Nelson firing, and a diving attempt, but incomplete. Wolitarski was open. Those are the type of plays, if you're Minnesota, you have to come up with in the passing game. It's fourth down.
Oh, it's a great first throw in the elements, the cold here. You never know how that ball's going to come out. Wolitarski is wide open. Ball's put out in front of him, and it's going to be difficult to operate handoffs through catching the ball in the passing game, the kicking game, catching the ball. We got to keep an eye on that all game because that ball is really dry, it's slick, and it's hard to control.
Peter Mortel will punt it away for Minnesota. And here is Abrideras on the 37-yard line, and he makes it to the 40. That's where Joel Stavi in Wisconsin will take over, and the Badgers have been tremendous offensively running the football this year.
And the thing that jumps out to me when I watch the tape for the last couple of weeks for Wisconsin, it's just that balance. The running game, the balance between Gordon on the outside, White on the inside, and then Abrideras, when teams try to come up and stop that run with an extra safety, Abrideras has been killing people in man-to-man coverage, not to mention the tight end, Jacob Pedersen, and Joel Stavi kind of getting more comfortable. That's created balance that really has helped Wisconsin.
Last week against Indiana, they went for a touchdown on their first play. James White, a 93-yard run. And they'll hand it to White, and he's able to break a tackle and get positive yardage. White is loose. Do they do it again? Two straight weeks. White inside the 30. Cuts it back at the 15 and gets down to the 12. They had him in the backfield, but White got free and a 49-yard run.
Well, Minnesota's going to have to tackle in space to be able to slow this offense. They had him bottled up there. Aaron Hill, 57, had a chance at him. Defensive line had a chance. And that's not a good start for Minnesota up front.
Took it to the house last week on the first play, a school record 93-yard run against Indiana. He almost took it the distance here. And so a first down at the 12-yard line of Minnesota. It'll be White again, and he's got running room. But cut down by the safety, Antonio Johnson, at the line of scrimmage. So to bring up second down and long.
And that's exactly what I'm talking about. This secondary is going to be dependent upon to tackle in space with both White and Gordon. Antonio Johnson, Demarius Travis, Cedric Thompson, all of them safeties for Minnesota are going to have to come up and make those tackles.
Joel Stavi, a sophomore quarterback. 16 touchdowns, 8 interceptions on the year. Started 6 games last year, then broke his clavicle. He's healthy this year. You got Gordon and the tail of an eye behind him on second and 10. Gordon leads the country in yards per carry. Fumbled the ball here, but it goes out of bounds and will stay Wisconsin football. These guys, Gordon and White, do not fumble, but it was knocked free by Aaron Hill.
They don't fumble, but they probably haven't played in 10-degree weather.
We had a fumble forward out of bounds.
Despite the fact that they play at Wisconsin, it's going to be difficult. Ball security has got to be the number one focus for both offenses in this game.
He fumbled it forward, so they go back to the original spot where he lost the ball. So a 1 yard gain, third down and long. Stavi gonna dump it off, right out in space, and a good open field tackle at the line of scrimmage by Devondre Campbell. So after that big play on first down, given up by the Gopher defense, they hold and force a field goal try.
Great job by Campbell. Two good tackles in the open field by Minnesota to get a stop inside the red zone. They give up the big play to White, but they come up with the plays when they need them in the red zone.
Now let's see here how the cold weather and the wind affects the kicking game. Jack Russell, been a little shaky in his career. His career long is 38 yards. 5 for 9 for his career, 5 for 7 this year. But has no trouble with this one from 31 yards out. And the Badgers are on the board.
Well, you give up a big play, but Minnesota's got a lot riding on this game. They get the stop they need on defense.
Head coach Gary Anderson's first experience with the Wisconsin-Minnesota rivalry. Badgers have won 9 in a row, so it's been one-sided of late. Anderson has done a terrific job, only 2 losses in his first season in Madison against Ohio State, and then the botched officiating at the end of the Arizona State game. We had that game, and Anderson's wearing basically the same attire he had that day. It was over 100 that day, and here it's around 15.
Well, everybody talks about Jerry Kill and the job that they've done here, but gosh, what Anderson has done coming in his first year at Wisconsin, very impressive. He's such a good coach, and he's got 2 coordinators that do an outstanding job.
I'm guessing he'll have gloves on by the second half. Told us he was going to try to make it throughout the game without him. There's KJ May from Minnesota trying to find a crease, and he's up past the 25-yard line to the 27. It was the kicker, Andrew Endicott, that made the tackle. As we look at our impact players, brought to you by Jared, the Galleria of Jewelry.
Well, and everybody knows about Chris Borland, the All-American linebacker for Wisconsin. Let me introduce you to 2 guys that are responsible for blocking him today. Drew Goodger, the tight end, and Mike Henry. Both those guys, to keep an eye on, number 30 and 83, trying to come through the hole on power plays and stretch plays. They're going to be meeting number 44 in the hole consistently. Can they rise to that challenge? Be a good question.
First opportunity here for Cobb to try to move the chains, and he gets to the 30-yard line, brought down by Ethan Heimer. David Cobb, a guy that was not on the season opening depth chart, but during this 4-game win streak, he's rushed for 142 yards a game and a pair of touchdowns.
Well, he was splitting time, remember, with Donnell Kirkwood and Roderick Williams, and they just found that he's the speed guy on the outside, David Cobb is, but he's learned how to run in between the tackles and become an all-purpose back.
That's his second carry so far today. As Nelson, and there's a flag down, dead ball foul. You saw Donovan Jones, a wide receiver, coming on that sweep action, but penalty marker on the play.
False start. Offense, number 65. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
That's the right tackle, Josh Campion, making his 24th straight start today.
And everybody talks about the offense for Wisconsin and how explosive it has been. But this defense, under new defensive coordinator Dave Aranda, and remember Gary Anderson's a defensive coach from Utah State, they have been outstanding, ranked 5th in the FBS in scoring, giving up only 14 points a game. And it's a new scheme. They went from a 4-3 to a 3-4. And these seniors have really thrived in that scheme.
How about this? You shift from a stack to an empty set, and they throw it out in the flat to Cobb, who's got a blocker. Pass the 30, and grabbed by Borland at the 33-yard line. A gain of about 8 on the play. Minnesota's been creative this year, and it's worked.
Oh, yeah. Matt Limegrover is going to line up in all kinds of formations and sets and motions and shifts. He says it's really taken some of the pressure off. They don't have, the biggest offensive line. They don't have the most explosive players on the outside, but the creativity that Minnesota has employed this year for Matt Limegrover is really what's allowed them to have success.
They gave Nebraska all kinds of trouble in a game in late October that Minnesota won part of this 4-game win streak. Nelson, and His pass is incomplete off the hands of true freshman Donovan Jones. So that's twice now that Minnesota's had catchable passes to keep drives alive and instead incompletions.
The ball's not going to be perfect on a day like this. It's not going to be perfect all the time. You got to make these plays. That's away from the body for Donovan Jones. And it's a difficult catch, but a catch he can make. And if you're going to beat Wisconsin, right, you got to make plays like that. And so when you throw the ball on third down, those are the plays you got to make. The first one to Wolitarski and that one to Jones.
Now Mortel the punt for the second time here in the opening quarter. Low kick in the sun. Aberdare is trying to locate it, just gets out of the way. And it continues to roll to the 30-yard line. Badgers with the football and a 3-0 lead. Love. 3-0 Wisconsin, and this season the Badgers are on pace to set a school record for total offense.
Yeah, a big reason why is the jet sweep. You hear a lot about this. I want to teach you about what this actually is. This is that Jared Aberderis in motion, number 4. And he's just going to get the handoff. The key is that he's at full speed. And you don't have to block the end of line of scrimmage, but you do have to block the perimeter. You release the tight end and the receiver, and you get a plus one. You also use the jet sweep as a diversion. This is Melvin Gordon, a very explosive player. You have to account for him on defense. You see how the defense reacts to Gordon. Then they give the ball to James White up the middle, and there's nobody left. It's a plus one offense, just like you have the zone read. But it's a different way of getting to it. And both Wisconsin and Minnesota in this game will try to employ it.
Second possession for the Badgers. First down on their 30-yard line. James White is the running back. On the rollout, Stavi looking downfield. And Aberderis, who went without a catch but had two rushing touchdowns, including one of the plays we just showed you in the game against Indiana last week, gets a first down to the 40.
I love watching Aberderis run routes. Just take a look. Against man, against zone, doesn't matter. He's such a technician. Looks back for the football when he's running. That tells the defender to expect the ball, and then he comes out of his break. It's just really good attention to detail from Jared Aberderis, and a lot of these young wide receivers in high school around the country could learn a lot from watching him on Saturday.
55th catch on the season. Here's Gordon shifting to the bottom of your screen with White at running back. White off the left side, able to shake a tackle, and brought down at the 46, but a 6-yard gain. Here's our impact players with Tom.
Well, Jared Aberderis just had his first catch, and if it's going to be any type of man-to-man situation, the matchup is Eric Murray, number 31 in the secondary for Tracy Clay's defense. He feels like he can hold up. So with all the jet sweep action, all the influence, the play-action pass, those one-on-one matchups should be there. However, if Aberderis catches a pass on third down, it will be a bust from a defensive standpoint for Minnesota.
Murray is from Wisconsin, so I'm sure that's extra motivation. They got him singled up on Aberderis here.
They say it would be a bust because their intent is to take away Aberderis on third down.
They run again on second down. And to the 48-yard line is James White, brought down by Scott Ekpe. So a third down here for the Badgers. They've been, as we mentioned, so good running the football. And you know, Gary Anderson said this is the way the team is built. This is what Brett Bielema did here and had a lot of success. We're not going to come in and try to change things when it's working.
Well, and this is where they had so much success in short yardage situations, third down. Keep an eye on the middle of the formation. Rashid Hageman, the defensive lineman for Minnesota, against Dan Volz, the center.
Here's White, and he's grabbed by Hageman and brought down short of the 50-yard line. So it's fourth down. We'll see if Wisconsin goes for it. Nope, the Badgers will punt it away. A big stop by Minnesota. Cedric Thompson, the safety, was in there for Minnesota along with Hageman.
Hageman just takes over Ryan Groy, the left guard, pushes him in the backfield, which allows the linebackers to come and fill in. Great job. Short yardage situation. Cedric Thompson, the safety, filling in the gap.
Hageman, a likely first-round or second-round pick in the NFL draft, makes a big play there. A line-drive kick that sticks at the 3-yard line. And Minnesota backed up inside its 5. Excellent kick by Drew Meyer. We thought we might get more bounce today because that field is hard as a rock, but it checks up.
ESPN College Football is presented by Cars.com. Get the right car without all the drama. Cars.com. All drive, no drama. And in part by the ultra-intuitive M-Series Smart TV from Vizio. It's beautifully simple.
Wisconsin and Minnesota have been playing for over 100 years. They started in 1948, battling for Paul Bunyan's axe. The original axe was donated to the College Football Hall of Fame in 2003. Last time Minnesota won it. You know what they played for in the 1930s?
Is some food?
The Slab of Bacon Trophy.
Slab of Bacon Trophy?
Yeah, I like the Paul Bunyan axe.
Lugendorf had a slab of bacon on his breakfast plate this morning.
Nelson throwing from his end zone on first down, going to the sideline, and again almost caught, but incomplete. Let's check in with Reese Davis in the studio.
Dave, Taco Bell studio updates I'm seeing on ESPN2 or ABC. Marcus Mariota had thrown 353 passes without an interception until that weird play in which the ball was saved back in bounds. The pick led to a score, and then Arizona went down the field and got another one. B.J. Dankert and Nate Phillips. It is 14-0 in the desert halfway through the first.
Oregon was complaining this week about maybe having to play in the Rose Bowl.
Yeah.
They lose, they won't have to worry about it.
Not the right attitude, that's for sure.
Here's Cobb, and a big hole off to the 10-yard line. Chris Borland, another tackle. A gain of about 6 on the play, but if you're Minnesota, Wolitarski, he could have caught that last pass before he went to Reese. That's twice now, and you also had a drop from Donovan Jones. I know these guys are true freshmen. It's the biggest game they've played in, but at some point, you're going to have to make a play. You've got to keep Wisconsin's offense on the sideline.
There's no question, and Wisconsin knows what the strength of Minnesota is running the football, so you're going to get man-to-man coverage predominantly throughout the course of this game. And you're right. You can't make an excuse about the conditions. You just got to make the play. Great throw by Philip Nelson.
Yeah, another situation here. We assume pass on third down and 4. Let's see, though. Nelson will throw. Moving around in the pocket. And now it's caught. A first down. Isaac Frickte, just his 9th catch of the year. That wasn't easy. He pulled it in.
Well, Jones drops one. Wolitarski drops one. So Philip Nelson says, I'll try Frickte. And Frickte makes a tough grab over the shoulder. Nice job by Philip Nelson. Buying a little bit of time. Sticking with the route. And Frickte knowing exactly how much yardage he needed to get the first down.
They shift to that two-back set with a fullback, Mike Henry. See if they pound it here. They roll with Cobb across the 20-yard line. Cobb past the 30 to the 33. That's a 16-yard run for David Cobb.
We talked about Drew Goodger, the tight end, getting the block on the linebacker, Borland. There he is right there. Take a look. Great seal block on the outside, and Henry gets a seal on the linebacker, Ethan Armstrong, and then a great hole for Cobb. Running the football is about an attitude, and you have to come in this kind of weather where it's going to sting every time you hit that defender, and you just have to tell yourself that for us to run the football and have success, we're going to have to bring maximum effort.
Cobb can't find a hole. Instead, he finds number 44, Chris Borland. Already 5 tackles in the opening quarter for Borland, who is a Butkus semifinalist, a Bednarik semifinalist, one of the best linebackers in the nation.
We were talking with his coach, Dave Aranda, the defensive coordinator, last night, and he says he's been the most favorite guy he's ever coached in his career. Just can't give him enough information, can't give him enough film to watch, can't give him enough motivation, and he's the unquestioned leader. And he uses more. He's not very big, 5'11", but he is strong at 246 pounds. And he makes just about every play on this defense.
They've been blitzing him a lot more. And here he comes, chasing down Nelson. Nelson's pass into traffic is knocked away and incomplete. Wolitarski, the intended receiver. True freshman Sojourn Shelton, who actually has 4 interceptions this year, was there for the Badgers defensively.
Yeah, and this crowd wants a pass interference call, but when you throw a ball up like this and it hangs in the air and it's basically a jump ball, you're not going to get the call from the official. That's basically a jump ball, and anybody has right to that, defense or offense. It's a good no call.
I agree. So third down and 8. Just shy of a 35-yard line.
Will Philip Nelson go back to Frickte? He's lined up down here in the slot.
Max Williams has been a third down weapon for Minnesota this year. Nelson, pocket breaks down. Nelson on the run and throws it away. Nobody open downfield and chased out by Connor O'Neill, and so Minnesota will have to punt.
We were talking with Matt Limegrover, the offensive coordinator, and he says that the thing that Philip Nelson does really well is operate that zone read, operate running that QB power, doing all those kinds of things. He's not as good in that drop back situation on third down. So if Minnesota is going to be in a lot of third and 8, it's going to be very difficult to move the ball.
Minnesota 1-4 on third down. Wisconsin 0-2 on third down. Mortel's third punt. It takes a Minnesota hop inside the 20 and rolls all the way inside the 10. About 25 yards after the initial bounce, 58-yard punt.
We talked about how deadly the speed sweep, jet sweep could be for Wisconsin. Here comes Melvin Gordon. Here's the approach from Minnesota. They said they were going to be aggressive. That's Antonio Johnson, the safety that just grabs Melvin Gordon and throws him down, taking a very deliberate approach and saying, we are not going to let number 25 run around this football field all day on the jet sweep. We're just going to tackle him no matter what. Clearly, that's the way they've coached Johnson.
Melvin Gordon comes in second in the Big Ten and ninth in the country in rushing yards per game. He is a Maxwell Award semifinalist, the only Big Ten player on that list. And technically, he's not the starter on his own team.
Hey, you get a hard argument for me to say he's not the best player in the Big Ten.
Here's White, and no running room. He's going to lose yardage. Excellent pursuit by Minnesota's James Manuel to get James White to the ground.
James Manuel, number 9, number 5 right here, Wilson. Here's Manuel. All three of these linebackers are going to have to fill the backside gaps. This time it's Wilson. Great job of going on the backside A-gap of that strong side power. Wilson's 254 pounds. He's got plenty of meat to deal with this offensive line up front for Wisconsin.
No gain on the play. Minnesota flipped the field. Remember, the Gophers had it on their 4. We got a couple of first downs and then a good punt. Here's a pass to Aberderis out in the flat. Actually looked like a backwards pass, so technically probably it'll go down as a run play out near the 13-yard line. It's a good pickup, but he's short. It'll bring up third down. Wisconsin 0-2 on third down today.
Well, this is the situation where Minnesota wanted to take Jared Aberderis out of the equation. 3rd and 4, whether they double him in this situation, but keep an eye on the tight end, Jacob Pettersson, because he's the one that'll get locked up in man-to-man coverage. He's right here in the wing.
3rd down and 4. Stavi checking at the line. Here's White. Nowhere to go. It's James Manuel again. The Badgers having trouble running the ball on this Gopher defense, and they have to punt.
That's a conservative approach. You're going to see all these linebackers are going to come up, and they're going to meet White in the backfield. That's James Manuel, but a very conservative call early in this game from Andy Ludwig. You talked to him about how Joel Stavi has been progressing, and there's a little bit of a hesitation. And I think early in this game, backed up inside their 15-yard line, they want to take the ball out of Joel Stavi's hand.
Minnesota looks like it's coming after this punt here on 4th down. And off the side of the foot of Meyer. And Minnesota will have possession right around midfield with a minute to go in the first quarter. And Wisconsin on top 3-0. Let's go to the studio and Reese Davis.
All right, guys, updating Florida State and Idaho. It's on ESPNU. Jameis Winston with the cloud of allegations surrounding him, finding a wide-open Kelvin Benjamin. Seminoles scored a couple of quick touchdowns in the first quarter on top of the 1-9 Vandals.
Reese, let's update Big Ten fans on some other scores. Ohio State up 14-0 on Indiana. If the Buckeyes win, then they go to the Big Ten championship game. That eliminates Wisconsin. Minnesota was eliminated today with Michigan State winning, but still an opportunity, obviously, for a great season for both schools. And Wisconsin still a crack at a BCS at large.
Good crack.
Here's Donnell Kirkwood. And a good run off the left edge on first down. A gain of about six before Nate Hammond makes the stop. 40th carry of the year for Kirkwood as they give David Cobb a break.
Now just watching this game from up here, this Minnesota team is not afraid to come toe-to-toe with Wisconsin. This offensive line has been chippy early. They are getting push on the defensive front for Wisconsin, and they are taking no prisoners.
They've taken on the identity of their head coach, Jerry Kill, with what he's gone through this year. Managing and treating his epilepsy, yet still coaching from the press box and being in there every day. Here's Kirkwood again, and he runs through a Badger and gets the first down to the 41-yard line. Nate Hammond tried to take on Kirkwood, and the Gopher back won that battle.
Well, and when you want to upset a top 10 team, attitude is the most important thing, and certainly Minnesota has it early in this game.
That's the end of the first quarter. In the battle for the axe, Wisconsin has won it the last 9 years, and the Badgers with a 3-0 lead after a quarter in Minneapolis. With the Big 12 title up for grabs, it's Win and Control Your Destiny Saturday night on ABC. Baylor and Oklahoma State from Stillwater. And the Bears still in the national championship picture if they can win on the road against a ranked team. It's been a long time since they've done that. Saturday Night Football presented by Windows. Baylor against Oklahoma State tonight at 8 on ABC. Here at TCF Bank Stadium, over 53,000 on hand. The largest ever for a game here. This venue opened in 2009. Minnesota, for about 25 years, played its games indoors at the Metrodome.
I'm impressed they all showed up when it's sub 20 degrees.
First down, Minnesota driving. Ball on the 41 of Wisconsin with the Badgers up 3-0. Off play action. And a catch made at the 35-yard line by Max Williams, but he fumbled the ball, and Wisconsin has it. Recovered by Derek Landish of the Badgers.
Just a naked route. He throws the flat, and Max Williams was going down, and that ball is clearly out before any part of Williams' body hits the ground. We've talked about how difficult it is to handle the football in cold weather. We've seen drops, and now Max Williams with a fumble.
Nate Hammond forced it free, and I'm not kidding. We were going to give a report about how slick the football is on the next play. So we're going to do that anyway with Tom, and obviously it fits in perfectly here, Luke. We'll get it with Tom after Wisconsin snaps it, unless they look at it and they stop it here to review it. So let's go ahead and bring Tom in.
The ruling on the field was the runner fumbled before he was down. The previous play is under further review.
But again, we think that the ruling on the field will be confirmed. Tom, tell us what you were going to about the football that Minnesota is using today.
Yeah, guys, there are various different ways you can deal with weather, but Minnesota is using what I would turn to be a very worn down, weathered, well broken in football. In my opinion, that makes the ball in these types of conditions more slick. Your hands are dry, very difficult to maintain control. So when you see Philip Nelson throw the football, you're going to notice a pretty significant wobble, and you're going to notice him having a hard time controlling the ball. Conversely, Wisconsin, they're using a newer ball.
That's confirmed. First down.
So when you knew that you use the newer ball, what ends up happening is you have more of the raised dimples on the hide, a little bit better ball control. Joel Stavi's using this, and you notice he's a lot tighter, a lot more velocity on the football in some of those throws. So it's a personal choice, but these are extreme conditions, and it's not just slipping for the quarterback, it's slipping for the receivers and the running backs as well.
And give Nate Hammond credit, too. He stuck his hand in there and poked the ball out for Max Williams to force the fumble as the Badgers take over, and Stavi to the air on first down and 10. And he'll take off and get back near the line of scrimmage. Obviously, Brian, you played at Michigan and played in the NFL in Chicago and Denver, so you've played in these kind of conditions.
Yeah, when it's very cold out, it's difficult on everybody. Whether you use an old ball or a new ball, it's so hard to get your hands warm enough with the moisture, and that's why you see Joel Staube has that little hand warmer there. It's not just for the warmth, but there's also some moisture in there. When your hand is dry and it's numb because it's cold, for every player, running backs, wide receivers, your emphasis again has to be on ball security first and then make a play second.
You surprised no gloves for the quarterback?
It's a personal preference.
Here's White, and he gets dropped after a gain of about 3 to the 36-yard line. Damian Wilson on the stop.
And I tried both. I tried not using the glove, and I tried using the glove. And what you sacrifice, at least from my perspective, when you have the glove on, was a little bit of accuracy. It feels differently. The spin on the ball coming out of your hand is different. But if that's more important, obviously, than protecting the football, then you're going to do it.
Temperature right now, 19 degrees. It feels like 5. Wisconsin yet to convert on third down. This is 3rd and 6 with the Badgers on top, 3-0. Staube gets hit as he throws it. It's an interception. It's picked off by Aaron Hill to the house. Touchdown, Gophers. Second touchdown of the year, a 39-yard return after the Staube interception. There was some pressure at Staube's feet from Michael Omefiela.
That's the 9th interception on the year for Staube. It's been his one Achilles heel in this high-powered, explosive offense for Wisconsin. And for Minnesota, if you want to spring an upset, turnover, score on defense, great way to start.
The fact, too, that you just turned it over after a nice drive, but they get it back, and they don't even need their offense to come out of the field with Hill taking it back 39 yards for a touchdown. Is rocking here, and it'll be rocking at Oxford tonight on ESPN. James Franklin is back at quarterback for number 8 Missouri as the Tigers take on Ole Miss. Jeff Scott is back and is a dynamic player for the Rebels. College football primetime presented by Hampton Hotels, 7:45 on ESPN.
That's going to be a great game. I can't wait to see how James Franklin reacts. You know, Jeff Scott's back for Ole Miss at home. Is Missouri thinking ahead a week to Texas A&M? They've got the chance for the SEC East, but they have no room for error. If they lose either one of these next two games, South Carolina will be in the SEC championship game.
And Missouri still has a shot to move up and maybe be a one-loss team that's in the mix for the national championship. But obviously, they got to win their next two and then beat Alabama, unless Alabama loses to Auburn in the SEC championship game. Here's Doe on the return for Wisconsin up to the 20-yard line and then run out of play at the 24.
Well, big interception return for a touchdown. Take a look at Michael Omefiela is going to come. We call this a grand twist. He goes around two defensive linemen. Then he gets to the quarterback, and he alters the trajectory of the throw from Staube. And he's trying to throw the ball underneath, and it goes right to Aaron Hill, the linebacker. You get hit like that, and you're trying to throw the football. It comes out very inaccurately away from where you're trying to throw that football, and an easy play for Aaron Hill.
That's the 9th interception this year thrown by Staube, and Minnesota has the lead. Gophers have not won 5 straight Big Ten games since 1962. That's what they're going for today. And a big hole as Gordon could not keep his feet, otherwise he might have scored, but as it is, 12-yard run. Eric Murray trips up. Melvin Gordon, who averages over 8 yards per rush, most in the country.
Well, and this is what is so explosive about Wisconsin's offense is they could just have a normal ho-hum run play between the tackles, and it could be a touchdown. A shoestring tackle from Murray. Gordon does not normally go down with one defender.
Gordon is a sophomore from Kenosha, Wisconsin. 6'1", 210-pound tailback. He gets it here. And Gordon with another good run. Picks up about 9 on the play. Eric Murray on the tackle. We saw him early in the season against Arizona State take it 80 yards for a touchdown. He's physical and has breakaway speed.
Well, and you got to give this offensive line credit, too. The stat that jumped out to me before this game and doing research was these backs average 4.3 yards before contact. Before contact. Wow. And so when you have a talent like Melvin Gordon and you have that kind of a head start, that's what's been so dynamic.
They go with J.J. Watt's younger brother, Derek Watt, to get it fullback, and Gordon gets the first down. Crossing midfield. Rashid Hageman not in right now for Minnesota. That's big. He does not play every defensive snap. But back to your point on the offensive line. Over the last 3 years, the Badgers have had 7 offensive linemen drafted. That's the most of any school in the FBS. And Ryan Groy at left guard probably has a future in the NFL. Their other guys are young. Tyler Merritts, the left tackle, he's a freshman. Dan Foltz, the starting center today, he's a redshirt freshman. There's Hageman watching from the Minnesota sideline. Play action. And Staube looking deep. Got Abrederis. Abrederis couldn't pull it in. A diving attempt as he beat Eric Murray, but it's incomplete.
This is the element that not a lot of people talk about for Wisconsin. They talk about the running game. As soon as you come up to stop it, Wisconsin knows they're going to have man-to-man coverage on the back end. And that time, that ball is perfectly thrown from Joel Staube. And again, we've seen receivers struggle with how cold that ball is. Normally, Abrederis comes up with that.
We've seen a few drops from Minnesota. That's the first one by Wisconsin. Would have helped out the confidence of the quarterback, too, after throwing a pick six on the last possession.
I like the play call from Andy Ludwig to get that confidence back for your quarterback.
Here's White. And White driven to the ground at the 46-yard line by Damien Wilson, Minnesota's leading tackler. So another third down situation here. The Badgers 0-for-4 on third down today.
And again, third and 6, third and 7. Too long to run the football. So in this situation, Minnesota's going to double. Abrederis, take that away from Joel Staube. The question is, will they get the football to Jacob Pedersen, who's really their best matchup?
And you see him there, 48 in White. He's lined up as a tight end on the left side of the formation. And Staube will throw incomplete, trying to hit Watt, the fullback. Pedersen stayed in the block, and even if Watt caught that, he was well defended. So it's fourth down.
Well, and so far, Minnesota defensively is winning the chess match on third down. They may be undermanned against the run, but on third down, they are taking away the security blanket for Joel Staube. That's Jared Abrederis, and forcing him to find somebody else to make a play.
So Drew Meyer will kick it deep. Marcus Jones, who has a punt return for a touchdown this year. So far, Wisconsin with 106 yards of total offense. They're averaging over 500 yards per game. Short punt. And the fair catch made at the 22-yard line. Not what Wisconsin had in mind there. Only a 24-yard punt.
I'm Reese Davis. Time for an innovative look brought to you by AT&T. Tonight, Baylor takes on Oklahoma State. And you know Bryce Petty will be counting the numbers in the box and seeing if he can create great stress on guys like the safety, for instance. This game against Texas Tech, Levi Norwood finds a big seam, a lot of open spaces, spread formations from Baylor. Oklahoma State's good at forcing turnovers. It'll be a great battle in Stillwater tonight.
Reese, a good one here. Second quarter in Minneapolis with the Gophers and Badgers both 8-2, and Minnesota on top of Wisconsin 7-3. And the Gophers with the football back. Philip Nelson has been sharp so far at quarterback for Minnesota. Here's Cobb, and he's past the 30-yard line to the 32. Good pickup on first down. Gain of close to 8 before Connor O'Neill makes the tackle. There's Jerry Kill who had an epileptic seizure and missed the Michigan game on October 5th. Since then, took time to focus on treatment and management of his epilepsy. And lately, he's been more and more involved. He's been in the press box now for the last five games, while Tracy Clays, who had been in the press box for 19 years as the defensive coordinator and various stops for Jerry Kill, has been the acting head coach down on the field.
It's been a bigger shift for Clays, obviously, going from up to down than it has been for Kill, even.
Here's Cobb on second and two, trying to bounce off tacklers. Great job with the second effort. The ball comes out. Looked like he had the first down, and they're going to blow it dead. It was recovered by Minnesota anyway, but they're going to blow it dead at the 36 and a Minnesota first down.
Yeah, there's no question he got yards for the first down. Fighting for extra yardage. And, yeah, he's down on the ground there before that ball comes out. But you got to really have so much respect for what Tracy Clays has done and what Jerry Kill has done. And, you know, in talking with Coach Kill yesterday, really I was impressed by the perspective that he has now. You know, he's talking about turning around a program, did it at Southern Illinois, Northern Illinois, now in the third year, has his team here at 8-2 after going 6-7 a year ago, and it's been really hard. Continue to beat your head against the wall, and he had to take care of himself, and he's done that.
Cobb makes one man miss, breaks a tackle, past the 45, and a first down to the 49-yard line. A 13-yard run for David Cobb.
Talk about the plus one and the speed sweep, opening up lanes on the inside. You make one guy miss, and he does that at the line of scrimmage. Great moves from David Cobb. You can see he's running with more confidence.
Connor O'Neill, who made the tackle there, paid for it. He's shaken up on the play. So 7-3 Minnesota. The other thing about what Jerry Kill and company, what they've been able to do here, this is a historically bad football program. The last time they won eight games was 2003. The last time they won a Big Ten championship was in the late 60s. Yet he's got them in a position, if they can win this game, to get their ninth win. They play Michigan State next week. Now, they can't go to the Big Ten championship game, but still, to even be in this position, given the coaching situation this year, is remarkable.
Outside of Auburn, Alabama, and Gus Malzahn, the job he's done, nobody's done a better job than Jerry Kill and his staff.
Here's the jet sweep, and Donovan Jones inside the 45 to the 43-yard line. Six-yard pickup for the true freshman Jones. That's his 13th carry on the year.
And I remember being here about a month ago when they were preparing to play Nebraska, and this offense looked like they couldn't move the ball for one first down, let alone win that game based on what happened against Iowa. And give credit to Jerry Kill, give credit to Matt Limegrover. They have found a way to produce on offense, even though they don't have the most talent. And now they're without their top wide receiver and two starting offensive linemen, and they're continuing to get production against a very good Wisconsin defense.
Here's second and two. They'll pound it. Cobb. And this time he's driven back and slammed down. Derek Landish sticking his face in there along with Ethan Armstrong. You mentioned the injuries. Derek Engel, wide receiver, leading receiver with 25 catches, by the way. It tells you how often they throw the ball. But a knee injury in practice. Tommy Olsen, a junior, starting in center for John Christensen, who broke his leg. Caleb Bach, the right guard, has a concussion, so Foster Bush is starting for the second straight game. They've beaten programs like Nebraska and Penn State here in the last month.
And I thought what was interesting from Limegrover last night was that they're trying to build this offense in fashion like Wisconsin. They have so much respect for how Wisconsin plays offense. That's how they'd like to look.
They fake the jet sweep, and now it's a quarterback run. Nelson has the first down. Borland finally tracks him down at the 35-yard line, but a 9-yard pickup.
And again, it's the speed sweep that influences. You come in motion, that affects the safety, who now doesn't come down to contain Nelson. He comes down for the sweep, which leaves a huge hole for Nelson and an easy third down conversion.
They were 3-9 2 years ago, Minnesota. 6-7 last year, made a bowl game. And 8-2 this year. In Jerry Kill's third year in Northern Illinois, they were 10-3. And then he got the Minnesota job. A stack formation here on first down at the 35 of Wisconsin. And Borland is in the neutral zone there. So a penalty flag down. Trying to guess the snap count. The officials will discuss if Borland was drawn off by Minnesota.
And Minnesota's plan early against Chris Borland has been effective. They have used different formations. They've used the threat of the sweep. They are confusing Wisconsin defensively right now and moving the ball on the ground because of
it. Ball starts, offense, number 52. 5-yard penalty, first down.
So the left guard, Zach Epping, you heard the crowd's response. They thought, as we did, that it was Borland that caused Epping to move.
Well, Borland came up right around the line of scrimmage. Here's Borland and here's Epping. They're bringing Borland on a blitz, and most times if that defender comes in the neutral zone and draws that offensive lineman off, they will call that on the defense.
They spread it out here on first down and 15. And a design quarterback run. Nelson slammed to the turf by Chris Borland. They get 4 yards back. Wisconsin, we talk about their offense. They're pretty good on defense this year. Fifth nationally in points allowed, only 19, and sixth nationally in yards allowed, giving up just 288. So far, they've given up 115 here in the first half to Minnesota.
And they've got to figure out this jet sweep element. They've run now Minnesota in this drive. Four times they've run jet sweep plays. They've gained 8 yards three times and 13 once. So that's what's being effective right now for Minnesota.
And they fake the jet sweep here, and Nelson throws high and incomplete. Trying to hit Donovan Jones. Faked it to Frichte, who is the receiver coming on the sweep.
This was the same play they had on the first third down of the game. The jet sweep is going to take the secondary out of the equation, and then he's just going to try to hit the backside skinny post, and he just overthrows it. Donovan Jones doesn't do a great job of giving him space to throw that football, but they missed on it on the first third down, and then they miss another opportunity here on second down. That's the kind of throw and catch that you got to make in these situations to stay ahead of Wisconsin.
You also had pressure from Pat Muldoon coming off the edge, and Nelson had to step up a little bit. Third down and 11. Out of field goal range here. Chris Hawthorne, their field goal kicker's long, is 45 this year. Nelson in trouble. Borland trips him up. Nelson gets hit. The ball's fumbled. Borland tries to pick it up, and he's got it. Eventually, it's recovered by Joe Schobert. And it's Wisconsin ball at midfield. Brendan Kelly was the man that forced it loose. Borland picked it up, and then it ended up in the arms of Schobert.
Well, Philip Nelson's got to throw the football. Guys open downfield. You can't hold on to it this long. You got to know that the defense is coming from behind. And certainly, they got to him, Brendan Kelly, and Borland picked it up.
And Borland handed it off to Schobert. That was dangerous right there. Lucky for him, it worked out. Recovery for Wisconsin.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Philip Nelson, a second fumble for Minnesota. You're going to see he's got a wide receiver open. Donovan Jones is running the under route. Right there he is. That's where the ball should go on time, on rhythm. Nelson decides he's going to wait and try to throw the corner route downfield. And the rush gets to him from behind. As a quarterback, you got to make quick, accurate decisions and get the ball out, especially when you're outmanned up front. And Philip Nelson didn't get it done.
Incredible record that Borland joins five others now with 14 career forced fumbles. Second fumble recovery for Wisconsin today. And the Badgers take over in midfield, trailing Minnesota 7-3. Here's White into the open field at the 30-yard line. Of around 20 on first down.
Again, it's rotation away from the speed sweep. Here they're all going to come. Watch the speed sweep, which opens up the lane on the inside for James White. White's got some of the best creases and holes in college football to run through, and a big reason why is because defenses have to respect that jet sweep element from Melvin Gordon.
Just to clean up some business, it was a fumble recovery for Boylan, not a forced fumble, so what you saw, just excuse. He didn't force the fumble. It was Brendan Kelly who forced the fumble, just to clean that up. Here's Stavi, and he's got a man open inside the 15. It's Pedersen, tackled by Brock Vereen at the 10-yard line. So another first down for the Badgers.
And a great throw from Joel Stavi. Aberderis takes the defense out high, and then Pedersen goes right behind the linebacker and the safety, and that ball is perfectly thrown from Joel Stavi. The thing that's been throughout the course of this year, impressive with Stavi. Yes, he will make mistakes. He will throw interceptions. He will hold the ball too long, but he never loses his confidence. He comes back with an aggressive attitude.
First down and goal for the Badgers. Stavi, and it's caught at the 5-yard line by Jordan Frederick. Brian, to your point, we had the Arizona State game where Stavi took a lot of flack because of how, even though the officials really messed it up, because he put the ball on the ground, didn't hand it to the official, and then didn't handle the clock correctly. But he bounced back from that and has played well since, for the most part.
Well, we talked with Gary Anderson about that last night. He said that Joel did exactly what he was coached to do. They actually had a tape, Andy Ludwig did, from his time at San Diego State, on how to execute that play, and Joel did exactly what he was supposed to do.
Although Coach Anderson said that's the game that will never end. He still thinks about it. The loss to Arizona State. Stavi in trouble. Throws end zone. And incomplete. Will there be a flag or not? There definitely was contact. And here comes the penalty flag. Eric Murray never saw the ball. I don't know how that can be considered a catchable ball, even with the push by Murray and Abradaris.
Pass interference. Defense, number 31. Penalty occurred in the end zone. Ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
I mean, Stavi got hit, so the ball fluttered out of his hand, and I don't know that Abradaris would have even had a chance to catch it. He was stopping to go to the football.
Well, certainly Murray didn't expect Abradaris to stop, but it was great pressure there by Cochran, 55, and Stavi tried to throw it, flutters, and you're right, and that's just a tough break for Murray. It was in good position, didn't expect Abradaris to stop.
So first and goal. Here's White, and wrapped up at the point of attack. White comes in, the active leader in FBS in career rushing touchdowns with 44. He was looking for number 45, but Antonio Johnson made sure he didn't get in.
Great play by Cedric Thompson. Here he is. Watch him shoot the backside gap. Very well done. He's unaccounted for in the blocking scheme on that power, and shoots so fast through there, he's able to get White before he gets to the end zone.
See if they try White again here. They will, and White is in for the Wisconsin touchdown. His 48th career touchdown, 45th on the ground, an FBS active leader in that category. And the Badgers are back on top.
You get inside the 5-yard line, and you know what's coming from Wisconsin. It's that power O, and there's the celebration. I love that celebration, man. It's good, clean fun right there from Melvin Gordon and James White. But you're going to get that power play over and over again until you show you can stop.
So the turnover by Minnesota leads to Wisconsin getting a touchdown. And now Jack Russell on for the point after. And it's 10-7 Badgers after James White gets his 13th rushing touchdown this season. And then Grease up here in the booth before the game is trying to get me to do the White Gordon celebration dance.
You
don't have
no
the rhythm
skills
these guys have.
I do. You don't. Speak for yourself.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy, and Battlefield 4, available now, rated mature.
The most played series in college football, dating back to 1890. And since 1948, they have battled for Paul Bunyan's axe. Minnesota has lost 9 in a row. The last win was in 03 here in Minneapolis at the Metrodome. Wisconsin with the lead. 2 fumbles by Minnesota inside the Wisconsin 40-yard line. Also a turnover by the Badgers, a pick 6 thrown by Joel Stavi. Aaron Hill with the return for a touchdown. Now a pooch kickoff here, and fielded at the 20-yard line, and the Gophers will have possession at the 26. Let's check in with Reese Davis in the studio.
Dave, Lex's halftime report is coming up. Oregon off to a sluggish start against Arizona. Johnny Manziel hit just 5 of his first 14 passes in an SEC showdown. And you won't believe what's happening in the swamp. I know Florida's not very good, but Georgia Southern in the fourth quarter trying to knock the Gators from any chance of being bowl eligible. But I do know they play Florida State next week anyway.
Yeah, and Florida State rolling again in its game today with Idaho. As David Cobb on first down cannot get away from Ethan Heimer making the tackle in the backfield for a 1 yard loss, second and 11. Let's go out on the field and check in with Tom Luganville.
No, this game has been sloppy at times throughout the first half, but being down here in the elements, I'm not so sure it could be played any other way. The ground is rock hard. You've got the wind swirling. The sun is now starting to set. Temperatures are going to continue to go down. This is going to be a battle of attrition, particularly in the trenches. Who makes the fewest mistakes wins.
Second and 11 here. They fake the jet sweep, and Nelson gets to the 30-yard line before he's grabbed by Borland and Landish. So that'll make it a more manageable third down. Third down and six for Minnesota.
I'm just glad that Tom can still move his lips down there. He definitely drew the short straw in the weather department today.
Well, we triple dog dared him to put his tongue to the goalpost before the game, but
I just pulled it off, guys. I regained my speech, and I'm back at full health.
Inside 2 minutes to go, Minnesota with all of its timeouts. Wisconsin has all of its timeouts. Third down and six. Nelson in trouble, being chased, and throws it away. Was he outside the tackle box? The ball did not get back to the line of scrimmage. Was there a receiver in the area? No. It's going to be grounding on Philip Nelson. Warren Herring was chasing him. So that's a loss of a down. They'll have to punt from around the 5 yard line with a snap coming at the 13.
Grounding. Offense number 9. Lost it down. Ball's placed at the spot of the fall. Fourth down.
That was a great job by referee Mike Cannon coming over there, checking first whether Nelson was out of the tackle box, then verifying that the ball did not get to the line of scrimmage. And after he saw those two things, he made the proper call. He was close to being outside the tackle box, but that ball did not get anywhere near the line of scrimmage.
And a chance here for Wisconsin to get good field position and get more points before halftime. The Badgers with all their timeouts. Mortel punting from his goal line. Right to Abradaris on a line drive. And he's to the 43-yard line. All right, time now for our Aflac trivia question. Which two former Wisconsin quarterbacks are current NFL starters? A little bit of a trick question.
No, that's not a trick question.
Current NFL starters. That could change
this
here.
This week, you mean?
In a little bit.
Yeah.
As the season progresses. By the way, this is a Wisconsin-Minnesota weekend. The Vikings and Packers play tomorrow in Green Bay.
That's a clue. People at home, everybody will get the first one because he's having an outstanding year, but second one, that was a clue for you. That's a Murray down, Eric Murray down on the field. Oh, it looks like he got sick there.
Murray has been covering Jared Abradaris.
Let's take a look
Wisconsin
at
wide receiver.
Murray comes in. Yeah, he got hit the collision and trying to make that tackle. Looked like he hit his head against one of his fellow teammates there, and he's up walking around. Looks like he's okay, but
he's got to come out here for at least one down. So how do they defend Abradaris here? You see the hard collision. Jalen Myrick, a teammate, and Murray collided with, so he's out here. We'll see if they go at Vereen, who is defending Abradaris. And a big hole for James White. He shoes one tackler and gets to the 25-yard line. It's an 18-yard run.
Great block by the fullback Watt. He's going to come out here and get the log on the outside linebacker. And that's a great jump cut from James White. The combination of Watt's block and that vision and jump cut from White got him to the second level.
Now Minnesota will call the timeout here. 1:20 on the clock in the first half. White already over 100 yards rushing. That's his eighth 100-yard rushing game of the season. All right, let's answer the Aflac trivia question. We said a little bit of a trick question, current NFL starters, because once Aaron Rodgers comes back, Scott Tolzien will not be starting for Green Bay, but
and Russell Wilson, the other one, obviously.
Yep. Russell Wilson for the Seattle Seahawks.
Good to see Scott Tolzien get his chance. You know, it's a great opportunity for him. You know that, obviously, for the Packers, Aaron Rodgers is going to be back, but great opportunity for him with a really good offense to see what he can do.
And Darrell Bevell, a former Wisconsin quarterback, used to be the offensive coordinator for the Vikings, is now the OC for Russell Wilson and the Seahawks. First down, Wisconsin at the 25 of Minnesota, leading by three late in the first half. Play action, Stavi steps up, and Stavi is loose inside the 20-yard line. Close to a first down at the 16. Damian Wilson tracks him down, and now Wisconsin will call the timeout. So two left for the Badgers. 1:08 remaining in the half. You see three games for you tonight on the ESPN networks, including Saturday Night Football presented by Windows on ABC at 8 with Baylor and Oklahoma State. Big 12 title up for grabs, but win and control your own destiny. Who are you picking in this one, Brian? Oklahoma State or Baylor?
You know,
what do you like?
Oklahoma State at home. Clint Schelf has been running the ball so well, along with Desmond Rowland. And, you know, Baylor, we know about that offense. We know about how explosive they can be. It's supposed to be cold. Weather's not going to be great. Stillwater's very difficult to play. And I think Oklahoma State is going to play toe-to-toe with Baylor tonight. Maybe get it done in the end.
Baylor lost its left tackle this week, so a little bit of depth issue.
Yeah, Drango's out.
By the way, Eric Murray back on the field defending Jordan Frederick here on second down on a yard. And Stavi will throw. Stavi gets hit. Ball flutters. Incomplete. Aaron Hill had his back turned, and Damian Wilson put his hands up like, oh, man, if you just turned around, you had another pick. James Manuel put the lick on Stavi.
Yeah, Manuel's just going to come on a delayed blitz right up the middle. As soon as he sees play action, he frees up. And this is the third time that we've seen Minnesota get to Joel Stavi right when he's throwing the ball. The interception for a touchdown, the first one. A couple of other times we've seen this, the aggressive nature of Minnesota's defense. They're going to take their shot. That's how Tracy Kill plays, likes to call this defense, and it's been effective in this game.
How about the linebacker play for Minnesota today and what they've gotten from Wilson, Manuel, and Hill? Let's see if they can come up with a stop here on third down and a yard. White and Watt in an offset eye, and it'll be a pass. And it's Watt, and it's too high and incomplete. What did you think of the decision there to throw the ball in these conditions on third down and one?
Well, the decision was excellent between Gary Anderson and Andy Ludwig. Look how wide open Watt is. The execution by Joel Stavi is the problem. You got to hit that. It could be a touchdown if you hit that. Great call, poor execution.
Okay, they're going for it on fourth down and one. How about this decision?
Well, now you run the ball. If I'm Andy Ludwig, Gary Anderson, I'm running the football here. Give it to my big back.
But why not? You're in field goal range. Why not just take the points here?
I think they feel confident and comfortable that they're going to get the first down on fourth and one. This is Wisconsin after all.
And Jack Russell's long in the year is 38. And Minnesota's going to call a timeout to talk about things. And that probably is factoring into the decision for Gary Anderson is, can Jack Russell make it from here? His long on the season is 38.
Yeah.
And it would be about a 34-yard field goal.
Well, and it's a good point because you've watched Jack Russell kick off a couple of times. They're going into the wind, and it hasn't looked really good. And I think you feel more confident in your ability to run the ball here with a minute left, still two timeouts left, plenty of time to still execute on the next set of downs. So I think this is a good decision to go for Gary Anderson.
You know, Wisconsin, a team that loves to pound the football. They've had no trouble running the ball with James White. It's been interesting. Melvin Gordon really hasn't gotten going yet. Only four carries to 13 attempts for James White. What do you make of that?
He doesn't need a whole lot of carries to do damage, right? I mean, he's that explosive back that, remember, he should have almost went for a touchdown on a shoestring tackle. Minnesota got him down. I fully expect either here in the second half to see more Melvin Gordon.
They've got White here. You know, their heavy package on fourth down and a yard. It'll be White, and he dives for the first down. at the 14-yard line. That'll stop the clock as they move the chains here. Wisconsin does have two timeouts remaining.
If you're Wisconsin, you want to hurry up here and run a play, take advantage of that clock stoppage and maintain your two timeouts. That's exactly what they're doing.
Let's keep an eye, too, on how Stavi and Wisconsin manages the clock here, given what we talked about earlier with Arizona State. Stavi hit again as he throws end zone and tried to hit Pettersson. But again, the contact with the quarterback impacted that throw. You had Antonio Johnson running with Pettersson.
Well, it's a good thing for Minnesota that they got, can run it here, guys, that they got to him because Pettersson was wide open on the route, on the corner route at the right side of your screen. They just ran a little twist there. And again, it was a muffler that got to him. He can get pressure. That may have been a touchdown to Pettersson.
So second down and 10 with a clock stopped at 37 seconds remaining in the half. Badgers by three. Stavi trying to set up the screen to White inside the 15-yard line and steps out. That'll stop the clock with 31 seconds remaining, and it'll be third down for the Badgers.
That was a great job defensively from Minnesota to sniff out that screen. James White is a killer in the screen game. He came into this game second leading receiver for Wisconsin with 31 catches, majority of those on the screen game. Great job to sniff that out. Here on third and seven, I expect pressure, more pressure from Minnesota because they've been getting that pressure on Stavi.
Badgers 0 for 6 on third down. They were stopped in the red zone in the first quarter by Minnesota's defense. Stavi, his pass is caught inside the 5, and it looks like a first down. Pettersson made the catch, 26 seconds left. First and goal Badgers.
Pettersson has been the reliable outlet for Joel Stavi, and remember, Minnesota in third down situations wanted to take away Aberderis, but they knew that they were going to be manned up with Pettersson. So far, it's worked out for them, and that third down, it didn't.
So the Badgers take a timeout. They have one remaining, 22 seconds to go in the half, and a first down and goal at the 3-yard line of Minnesota. So with that timeout, they have options to do what they do here in goal line and run the ball if they want.
And I think this series has been very well managed by Gary Anderson and this Wisconsin coaching staff to go for it on fourth down, not take a chance with the field goal into the wind, to maintain their timeout, get up there and run a play on first down, and now they're in a great situation they can run a pass.
Andy Ludwig, the offensive coordinator in his first year. It's also his first year in cold weather. Somebody was telling him about negotiating the wind, and he said, I don't even know what you're talking about. I've been on the West Coast. And now he has a chance to kind of see how things have played out in the first half, and that might impact what he does in the second half with play calling.
I might run play action on first down. That way, if I don't get it, I don't take too much time, and I can run it on second down and still have a timeout.
Play action. Stavi going end zone, and again overthrew his man. Trying to hit Sam Arneson. 17 seconds left. Second and goal.
And that's people at home might think, oh, that's a bad throw. That's a safe throw. The last thing you want to do here is take a chance unnecessarily. And Arneson wasn't really that wide open. This is a tough throw for a quarterback because you don't have a lot of space. He just threw it safe. Now you only take 5 seconds off the clock. You can come back in this situation and run the football because you still have a timeout.
Watt in front of White in the backfield. It's White on second and goal, and he will not make it. And that's going to force Wisconsin to use its final timeout of the half with 10 seconds left. Antonio Johnson, the safety, on the stick. So third down and goal, you're out of timeouts. The ball is going to be spotted just inside the 2-yard line. What are you thinking here?
And while you would have hoped if you're Wisconsin you could run the ball in that situation, what Gary Anderson just did there was ensured that he had 3 shots at the end zone. He knows he's really good at running the football. He definitely wanted to have that, but he also earned himself another shot at the end zone here on third down. Whether they make it or not, I don't know, but it's very well set up and managed by Gary Anderson.
If they decided to take a chance and run the ball and not get in, they would not, obviously couldn't spike it because it's fourth down. They would not have enough time to get their field goal team on. So if you're Minnesota, are you assuming pass here no matter what?
Absolutely. You're assuming pass. And if I'm talking to Joel Stavi, because he's not the most fleetest of foot, I'm saying you throw this ball. There's no option for you to run to try to get this ball in if guys are covered.
11 seconds remaining. No timeouts left for the Badgers. Third down and goal just inside the Minnesota 2.
Certainly not a passing set.
Play action. Stavi. The pass deflected and incomplete. Nearly intercepted by Cedric Thompson. And it's fourth down and goal. And Wisconsin has to settle for a field goal try.
Derek Watt was wide open. This will end up being a 7-point or 4-point play. Here's Thompson right here. He's going to rush, and then he reacts. He's out of position, but makes a great effort and a great play just to get a hand on that football to knock it away.
And so Jack Russell on for a 20-yard field goal try. Made a 31-yarder in the first quarter. And the Badgers get 3 points at the end of the half here, but that's twice now in the red zone. Minnesota's been a decent red zone team in terms of touchdowns allowed. Tracy Clays and company hold Wisconsin to a field goal again.
I think if you told Jerry Kill, Tracy Clays, they'd be down 6 at halftime against Wisconsin, they'd take that. This kind of a game in this situation, at home, keep this crowd in this game. They have played well on defense and give up 13 points to an offense that comes in just blowing defenses out of the stadium in the first half the last 4 or 5 weeks. I think that's a win.
Minnesota with no offensive points, the only touchdown coming on defense. And the Badgers put 51 up on the board last week against Indiana, winning their fifth straight since a loss at Ohio State by 7. They also lost at Arizona State by 2. And they're number 19 in the BCS standings. They need to be in the top 14 to be eligible for an at-large, assuming Ohio State wins one of its final two games. They're leading Indiana by 21, last check. Michigan State eliminated Minnesota from going to the Big Ten Championship with the Spartans winning in Evanston today.
The second half will be about ball security in a one-score game. Anything can happen when the conditions are like they are currently.
Got a short kickoff and a fair catch made at the 25-yard line with a second left. The clock says 000s on the scoreboard. We'll see here if they put a second back on it.
Please reset the game clock to 3 seconds.
It was touched right at 3, so there you go. So 3 seconds as one of the offensive linemen.
Ernie Heifort, give him a little love. He just caught that ball on the kickoff. Backup offensive lineman. His family at home watching. Great job by Ernie. It's not easy to catch that ball.
Hey, we've seen wide receivers today drop
yeah.
it. Minnesota just takes a knee, and that's the end of the first half. Badgers will get the football to start the second half. Leading Minnesota 13-7. Trying to keep Paul Bunyan's axe for the 10th straight year. Minnesota trying to pull the upset. Let's check in with Tom.
Got to feel good about the defensive momentum there, getting that stop before halftime. How would you assess your defensive performance?
You know, so far I think we've battled hard and kept in control. The 2 turnovers give them 2 extra possessions, and they're just too good to give them the ball that off. But our kids on defense are fighting right now.
You guys have made some flashes in the run game on offense, but most of the passing game has struggled in the drop back as Philip Nelson's holding onto the ball. Yeah. Could we potentially see some movement of the pocket in the passing game?
Well, we got to be a little more stouter up front, you know, and they're pushing us back is what they're doing. So offensive line's got to be a little bit more stouter and hold that pocket a little longer.
All right, good luck, Coach.
Thank you.
And Tom, they have some injuries on the offensive line, but that D-line for Wisconsin, pretty good. And the Badgers have a 6-point lead on Tracy Clays and the Gophers. Stay tuned for the Lexus Halftime Report.
This is College Football on ESPN, presented by Cars.com.
for the Wisconsin touchdown. So at the half,
oh, good one.
13-7 Wisconsin leading Minnesota. Both teams 8-2. Paul Bunyan's axe at stake. Dave Pasch, Brian Greasy, Tom Luganville down on the field. Temperatures in the teens. Wisconsin averages about 300 rushing yards per game. The Badgers halfway there. Minnesota staying in it by getting some pressure on Joel Stavi, the quarterback.
It's been more of the same for Wisconsin on the ground, and they've been using that jet sweep we talked about at the beginning of the broadcast. Here comes Aberderis in motion. Watch how it affects the rotation of the defense from Minnesota. They bring that safety up and rotate back with Vereen, which creates an ideal look for James White to run. And as he breaks that line of scrimmage, he's been making some plays in the secondary. For Minnesota, it's been their defensive pressure that's really kept them in the game. This twist around affects Stavi throwing the football, and that's where Aaron Hill came up with that big pick six. That's been the only score for Minnesota in the first half. Second half's gonna be about who can make the fewest mistakes and who can protect the football, because the elements are going to get even worse as time goes on. It gets colder down there.
Two turnovers by Minnesota in Wisconsin territory, and then the pick six that you saw by Aaron Hill for the only score for Minnesota. Two holds by Minnesota when Wisconsin got inside the 20 to force field goals. Badgers get the football here. Chris Hawthorne to kick it deep. Kenzo Doe, the return man for the Badgers, a short kick. Doe from the 7. And Doe will not reach the 20. He's grabbed at the 15-yard line. Jalen Myrick down there for Minnesota. Time for our Discover Game Changer, brought to you by Discover Card.
Well, it's been this rushing attack we knew coming in, the combination of Melvin Gordon and James White, very difficult to stop. I think Minnesota's done a pretty good job. It's just been a couple of times where they have cracked that line of scrimmage and gotten some yards, but certainly when Wisconsin's gone to throw the ball, they've gotten great pressure on Stoddard.
They got 49 yards on the ground on the first play. James White with 15 carries to just 4 for Melvin Gordon in the first half. It'll be White here for the Badgers, and he's tripped up, diving to the 22 for a gain of a handful. Here's Tom.
Well, Jerry Kill at Minnesota told his football team at halftime, he said, guys, have fun. You've got a packed stadium. It's a rivalry game. We're battling for the axe, and we've been our own worst enemy. Clean up the football game, and at the end of the fourth quarter, you're going to be pleased with each team.
Get some more Vaseline on those cheeks, Tom, to help with the wind.
Actually, we're running low. We have a supply and demand problem down here, fellas.
On second and 5, Stavi will throw it to Aberderis, gets a block, and is close to a first down. Antonio Johnson made the tackle. It is a first down for the Badgers.
Well, if you're going to double team Jared Aberderis, they're going to try to give him the ball in a bunch of different ways. This time on just a quick screen, it gets a nice block from Jordan Frederick. But Aberderis needs to have 10 to 15 touches in every game that Wisconsin plays. And if you're going to double team him in the passing game, they're going to give him to him on the speed sweep, give him some quick throws on the outside.
Had two rushing touchdowns against Indiana last week, but was held without a catch. Stavi off play action, setting up, airing it out. Aberderis on the grab near midfield before he's brought down by Antonio Johnson. The confident throw there by the quarterback, Joel Stavi.
Absolutely, and I like the aggressive approach from Wisconsin early in the second half. Man-to-man coverage. Anytime you get man-to-man coverage as a quarterback, I would feel confident in Jared Aberderis' ability to get open. And that time he's matched up on the safety, Antonio Johnson, which is a mismatch that Wisconsin will win every time.
A 21-yard pass play. Stavi to Aberderis. White off the right side, spun down by Botticelli. Pickup of a couple.
It looks like Wisconsin is going to go a little no huddle here. Different change, something that you're not used to seeing out of them.
Here's Aberderis out in the near flat, past the 40-yard line, inside the 30 before he's run out of play by Cedric Thompson. So we've seen two screens to Aberderis on this drive.
Well, I give Andy Ludwig, their offensive coordinator, credit. Up tempo. He's probably called these four or five plays, talked about them at halftime in the locker room, gave everybody the heads up. Here's what we're going to do. We get a first down. We're going to go up-tempo, and we're going to run the screen to Aberderis. And that advanced planning and preparation has really helped him in his first drive.
That play went for 22 yards. Inside the Gopher 30. Again, Wisconsin's been down here a couple times and punched it in once. Had to settle for two field goals, though. White trying to pick a hole. Gets inside the 25-yard line. They're getting much better production on first down since that opening quarter, save the opening run by James White. That was a gain of 5 on first and 10.
Well, you see a little bit of the change in approach from Andy Ludwig in knowing that this Minnesota defensive front, Hageman and the linebackers, they have had success stopping the run in the first half. So what do? They come out in the second half, 3 passes in a row to open the game.
Here's White, and Hageman with a big play. Beats his man, the center, Dan Volz, and then takes down the running back.
This is what you're waiting to see from Rashid Hageman. He has the ability to blow up offensive lines and completely dominate games. We were talking last night with Jerry Kill, Tracy Clays, about Hageman, and I asked Clays, how come he doesn't play every single snap? He's one of the best players in college football, the best defensive tackle, in my opinion, in the Big Ten. Why doesn't he play 70 snaps? He says, well, he can't do that as a defensive tackle, so he likes to save him for the second half. We'll see how he affects the game in this next 30 minutes.
Only one third down conversion for the Badgers. But wide open is Wozniak, and close to the first down. It looks like he's got it based on the spot. So they pick it up through the air on third down and 7. Only the third catch of the year for Brian Wozniak, tight end.
Well, you take care of Aberderis, you take care of Watt, and here he is right here, just hiding in the backfield. He's going to chip and get out late. Great read there by Joel Stavi, not trying to push the ball down the field, just manage the game, get first downs, and keep the drive alive.
You have 3 tight ends in there on first down. Stavi looked like he lost his balance a bit and throws caught inside the 5, but a penalty flag down. Pedersen to the 4-yard line. Cedric Thompson on the coverage. Flag was thrown on the near side at the line of scrimmage.
Holding offense number 79. 10-yard penalty, replay first down.
That's Ryan Groy, the left guard. Here he is right here. Gets that left arm out. And you get in that situation, and defensive linemen are taught to flail their arms to draw attention. No, they are. Flail your arms, and that's exactly what Roland Johnson did, and draw the attention of the official.
By the way, some breaking news on the bottom line for NBA fans. Derrick Rose with a severe right knee injury. He is out indefinitely. Remember, it was the left knee last year, tore his ACL last year. First and 20 for Wisconsin. Stavi with a pocket to throw from. Low pass, but a catch by Pedersen inside the 20. They've had so many good tight ends at Wisconsin over the years, and Pedersen another one. Let's see if he was able to pull this one in. Excellent grab.
Yeah, good job of digging that out. Not the best throw from Stavi, but Pedersen goes down and helps his quarterback out, and that's a big play there, because you have a penalty, a hold on first down, first and 20 in the red zone. Very difficult to get a first down in that scenario, but now you get half of it back to bring down a manageable second and 10 situation.
Drive that's gone 5.5 minutes. Again, twice they've been down here and had to settle for field goals. Second down and 10 of the play clock at 4. They run the ball with White, and he's brought down at the 15-yard line. Well, that D-line for Minnesota getting off blocks. Scott Ekpe, sophomore, was there to make the tackle. So it's third down and long. The Badgers just converted a third down and 7 earlier on this drive.
If I'm Tracy Clays, I might think about dialing up some pressure. You've gotten to Joel Stavi, and it affected a number of his throws. But he has Cochran, De'Aaron Cochran, Hageman up front that are good pass rushers, and then Amefala, who he's used moving around quite a bit. We'll see if they decide to come after him.
They rush 5. Stavi going to throw to the end zone for Aberderis. Broken off, but a flag. The defender, Demaryius Travis, did not get his head around and contacted Aberderis. That's the second pass interference thrown on a Minnesota DB in the end zone.
Pass interference, defense, number 7. Penalty occurred in the end zone. Ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
And you got to look back for the football as a defender. You've got to look back for the football. You said it. Second time, this is too easy. If I'm Wisconsin, I'm just going to throw the ball in the end zone like this every time to Aberderis, because nobody's looking back for the football. That's an easy call for the official. They came after him up front. Look at the job of the offensive line.
Derek
Watt. Great job by Derek Watt. Yeah, giving that pocket to Joel Staubing. Joel Staubing did not throw a good ball there. It was so bad that it was an easy interference call.
Here's White trying to keep his balance and then driven to the ground by 3 Gophers led by Damian Wilson. So second and goal. It's been a 6.5-minute drive by the Badgers.
Again, Rashid Hageman coming out of the ball game. I think this is the area of the field where you would want him the most.
Is he injured? That's what you wonder. Or is it by design to bring him out here? I wonder why you would take him out.
I honestly don't know. I don't have. If I were coaching, he'd be in for me.
Second and goal. Play action. Stavi, end zone. Aberderis with the touchdown catch. That's the 7th touchdown reception for Jared Aberderis, and Wisconsin leads it 19-7.
Aberderis just runs a great route on Eric Murray. It's a very similar route to what they tried at the end of the half. They cover Watt in the flat, but Murray just didn't have tight enough coverage on Aberderis.
Russell puts it through as Wisconsin takes up almost half the third quarter on that drive, and Staubing gets his 17th touchdown pass of the year.
Great job by Aberderis. Going back to get that ball. Wasn't perfectly thrown. He had to go back and get it, but puts Wisconsin up by 13.
Celebrating its 9th year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. Since 2005, Allstate has contributed more than $3.3 million in scholarship monies. Dave Pasch, Brian Greasy, Tom Luganville in Minneapolis, where temperatures in the mid-teens, wind chill inching closer to zero.
Couldn't help but see behind that Allstate net they had burnt ends for a sale back there, and cheese curds, jalapeno cheese curds here in Minnesota. I don't know they had that in Wisconsin.
They're catering to the many Badger fans that are here. As offensive lineman again has it on the kickoff. It's Ernie Heifert again. That's the second time that he's fielded a kickoff.
Keep pumping him.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by USAA, proudly serving the financial needs of current and former military members and their families. And the new Windows. Tweet your Saturday Superfan photos to College Game Day for a chance to win a trip to a bowl game.
Minnesota led 7-3 early in the second quarter, but it's been all Wisconsin since. Aberderis with a touchdown grab for the Badgers, and they're up 13 on Minnesota as they look for their 9th win, trying to go to 6-1 in the Big Ten, keep their hopes alive for a BCS at-large. Ohio State looks like it's going to take care of Indiana and make it to the Big Ten title game. Cobb grabbed by Borland, and Borland forces a fumble, and he comes up with a ball. What an incredible play by Chris Borland. There's a penalty flag down, but my goodness, if that stands, not only would he match the FBS record for most forced fumbles in a career, but he got a fumble recovery, which would be his second of the game. It's on Minnesota.
Personal foul, hands in the face. Offense, number 30. That penalty's declined. Result of the play is a fumble recovered by Wisconsin. First down.
One of the best plays you'll ever see by a linebacker here against the run.
Well, here he comes. He's one of the best guys at diagnosing plays and being ahead. And you said it. Once he gets him wrapped up and stopped, he goes immediately for the turnover and the strip. That's textbook middle linebacker from Chris Borland. And before this series started, he was over there on the sideline trying to get his team pumped up. This is a defense that is overlooked because of the explosive offense, but they have played outstanding all year long, coming to this game fifth in the country in scoring defense, and Chris Borland's a big reason why.
Joins five others with 14 career forced fumbles, the most in FBS history. Stavi rolling out, dumping it off to Pettersson. Pushed out by Aaron Hill inside the 25. As Minnesota is in must-stop situation here with Wisconsin taking up half the quarter on the initial drive of this period.
Yeah, since the 5:38 mark of the second quarter, Wisconsin has now run 30 plays, and Minnesota's only run six.
Wow. And Minnesota was in a situation down 20-7 that it needed to move the football, if nothing else, just flip the field, but they turn it over on the first play. They shift right into the backfield, and Gordon, we'll see if they run that jet sweep with him. Here he comes. Hand it off to White, though, inside the 25, and diving is Travis to make the tackle at the 20 to bring up a third down at about four. Wisconsin 2-for-3 on third downs recently after starting 0-for-6. We'll see what they dial up here. White, a little dinged.
Well, and Melvin Gordon comes back into the game as they'll take a look at James White on the sideline. We haven't seen a whole lot. You mentioned it late in the second or the first half. Haven't seen a whole lot of him in this game.
Well, he was in there on that last play faking that jet sweep. Now he's lined up in the backfield next to Stavi on third and four. The Gophers need this here. They need a stop. And they'll bring pressure on Stavi. Stavi rolling out, being chased, fires incomplete. Trying to hit Jordan Frederick with Eric Murray all over him. And so the Badgers will attempt a field goal.
Great job by the secondary. Murray, take a look as we run this play, how good the coverage is. Man-to-man on the back end. One to go to Aberderis. He's covered right here. Nowhere to go, nowhere to go. Good coverage. And then a late outlet is knocked down by Murray. Good job in getting that stop and transition defense after the turnover from Minnesota.
So Jack Russell trying to match a season-long and career-long with a 38-yard field goal attempt. And it's not a good snap, and the kick isn't good either. He missed it. Enormous for Minnesota after the turnover deep in its own territory. It was a poor snap by freshman Connor Udelhoven. The holder, Drew Meyer, tried to get it down in good position, and Russell pulls it.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the WatchESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
They pass Brian Greasy, Tom Luganbill in frigid Minneapolis. Wisconsin missing a field goal after getting a takeaway by Chris Borland. And so Minnesota ball trailing by 13 midway through the third quarter. Warming the water to give to the coaches and players here. The temperature in the teens,
jeez,
feels like about zero.
When the water in the ice bottle gets, when the water bottle gets icy, that's not a good sign.
David Cobb in the backfield. He fumbled the last time he touched it. Play action here for Nelson on the rollout. And there's no receiver out there. He's pushed out.
Good job. Good
job. Near the line of scrimmage. Actually going to give him a couple yards here. Oh, nope. They'll spot it back at the 20. There's Dave Aranda, first year defensive coordinator. Hired by Gary Anderson after 1 year with Anderson at Utah State.
Yeah, he came over from Hawaii and an outstanding football coach. We had a chance to meet with him twice this year. Of all the coaches that we see on a weekly basis around college football, Dave Aranda is one of the most impressive. Brought a great attitude. It's kind of a philosophy of defense that's been very impressive.
Cobb off, spins out of the tackle and crosses the 25, gets to the 27-yard line.
And the biggest change that Gary Anderson and Dave Aranda have brought is the scheme of defense, moving from a 4-3 to a 3-4. And Dave Aranda is one of those coordinators that loves to be aggressive. We were talking with him last night. He loves to bring pressure off the edge. That's what they did at Utah State. That's what they did at Hawaii, try to take the fight to the offense, create turnovers. What he realized with this defense from a personnel standpoint is that they didn't have those kinds of players, so he's had to make that adjustment mid-season, and the results have been fantastic as this defense continues to thrive.
There's third and five. They'll roll Nelson left, and he throws a pass that's nearly intercepted, then nearly caught. Tanner McAvoy almost picked it off. On the redirection, Logan Hutton was there for Minnesota. Neither could pull it in. Minnesota has to punt.
And these are the plays that Dave Aranda loves to see. He loves turnovers. And you mentioned McAvoy. You're not going to get a more textbook opportunity there to catch that and run it back for a touchdown. That's the dream of a safety. Wow, they're going to be on him in the team meeting on Sunday.
So another punt here, as Wisconsin's defense has shut down the Minnesota offense after the first quarter. They need a good punt from Mortel, and sliding is Aberderis with a fair catch at the 42-yard line. So good field position for Wisconsin. Coming up tonight on ESPN, it's college football primetime presented by Hampton Hotels. Missouri controls its own destiny, but they got Ole Miss on the road, then Texas A&M at home. What do you like in this game tonight? James Franklin is back for the Tigers, a quarterback.
I think something that nobody's talking about is the injury to Charles Sawyer, the corner for Ole Miss. Their starting corners in that game tonight will be 5'8 and 5'9, going up against Doriel Green Beckham at 6'6, Damian Washington 6'4, Marcus Lucas 6'5. It's going to be something to watch tonight.
Here's Gordon on first down, finds a hole, and a touchdown saving tackle with Gordon's speed. Cedric Thompson at the 47-yard line, as it is a gain of 11.
Well, here he is right here, Cedric Thompson. He's going to be the last line of defense. And you see the effect of that jet sweep that takes just a little bit of the edge off up front. And Melvin Gordon averages for his career 8.5 yards a carry. 8.5 right. yards a carry. The reason he does that is because he has such great speed, and when he gets to that second level, a lot of times that tackle doesn't happen. He's in the end zone.
And Stavi again stumbles, and Gordon met at the 43-yard line, powers for an extra yard of the 42, so a 5-yard pickup. Think about it. Last year, Monte Ball won the Doak Walker Award. He was a second-round pick of the Broncos. They replaced him with Melvin Gordon, who's rushed for over 1,300 yards, and James White, who is a freshman, rushed for 1,000 yards. Didn't get as many touches the last 2 years, but is back as the featured guy. They also have a true freshman in Corey Clement, who's rushed for over 500 yards this year.
I think at the end of the day, Dave, when it's all said and done, they're going to be talking about Melvin Gordon as the best back to ever play in Wisconsin. That's how good he is.
Better than Ron Dane?
Absolutely.
Here's Gordon spinning out of the tackle, breaking another one. Trying to drag defenders. Drop down at the 40. It brings up third down and about three.
And when I say that, I mean for their career, both in college and in the NFL. I think Melvin Gordon has got that type of athletic ability, the size, the speed, the intelligence, the smarts, as this year he's really taking it on himself to learn the offense. Where do I go on protection? How do I read blocks? He's got the total package. Ron Dane had an okay NFL career. I think Melvin Gordon can be a superstar.
Ron Dane rushed for almost 8,000 yards in college. Third down and three. Here's White, stumbles and goes down. He lost yardage, and so fourth down, and Wisconsin not going to mess around here and try and go for it. They're going to punt the football. It'll be interesting to see next year when White isn't there. Now they have Clement. Does Gordon get more carries? And if that happens, does Gordon get in the Heisman conversation? Think about it. He's a sophomore. He is a semifinalist for the Maxwell Award. Goes to the best overall player in college football. He's the only Big Ten guy on that list. Meyer punting, trying to pin Minnesota deep. Decent kick, and the Gophers will have the ball at their 15-yard line as it's secured by Marcus Jones. Let's take a look at this week's BCS standings, brought to you by Discover Card. Ohio State up big on Indiana at last check. Florida State and Alabama winning their games as well. And what happens tonight with Baylor, Oklahoma State?
will make things interesting tomorrow night. Oregon was losing also today to Arizona.
Yeah, I mean, Oregon was down 28-9, I think, in that game. But, yeah, 4, 8, and 10 there. Baylor, Missouri, and Oklahoma State, those are the games tonight. And that game, Missouri and Ole Miss, is no gimme either. So there could be, we know late in November, there's always shakeups, significant shakeups every week in that top 10 standing. And I think this Saturday will be no different.
First down for the Gophers, and they're going to run Cobb. And Borland grabs him. Cobb, though, able to push the pile to the 20. If you're Minnesota, how much longer, down two scores, can you go with this method here of just trying to run the football? What point do you let Nelson throw it? They're without Engel, their top receiver.
Well, yeah, they don't throw the ball. This is their MO. This is who they are. So it's not like you have an option to just come out and drop back and throw the ball all over the lot. They have to think, Tracy Clays and Jerry Kill right now are thinking, we're down 13 points. That's two possessions. We're going to shut out Wisconsin in the fourth quarter. We just have to take our time and get some points.
They hand it to Wolitarski on the jet sweep, and he gets a first down to the 26-yard line. You saw the late reaction by the linebacker, Ethan Armstrong. That allowed Wolitarski enough room to get upfield and move the sticks.
And that's big. That first down of a drive is always big. Now you can come back and start to get a little bit of confidence. Again, they haven't had the ball since the middle part of the second quarter. Got to get a rhythm back.
Time of possession, 16 minutes for Minnesota. They're 26-4 Wisconsin. First down for the Gophers, and Cobb on the run. And he powers to the 30-yard line and stuffed there. Wisconsin trailed 7-3. It's been all Badgers since. And with a minute to go on the third, they've got a 13-point lead. A pair of 8-2 teams meeting for the 123rd time in the most played series in FBS. Paul Bunyan's axe, owned by Wisconsin the last 9 years, on the line. It'll make its way at some point here soon out to the field. And it's always fun to watch the reaction of the winning team to chase down that axe and the first guy to get there.
And that's demoralizing to the other team, too, as they come across your sideline, jump over your seats to go get your trophy. That doesn't feel good. I've been there.
Nelson with all kinds of time. Got to throw it deep for Donovan Jones. There's contact. No penalty flag. Darius Hillary on the coverage. How's that any different from what we saw earlier on some passes intended for Abradaris, where there was contact?
Well, let's see. Did Hillary look back for the ball? We see this every week. If the defender looks back for the ball, they're going to give him the benefit of the doubt. He looks back late, but that could have been called easily. But any effort by that defensive player to look back for the ball is going to be looked on favorably by the official. That's just the way it is.
Even that late.
I think that was a penalty, but I'm saying I think why they didn't throw it was he tried to look back for the ball.
So third down and 6 for Minnesota, late third. Nelson with time, and it's incomplete, intended for Max Williams. There was a lot of contact on that play. Williams shaken up. It's fourth down.
Well, without Derek Engel, Max Williams is their biggest threat in the passing game, and they got what they wanted. He was manned up. Ball is perfectly thrown, and that's going to be a difficult catch when he comes down on the ground. Schobert's on top of him, and that ball comes out.
Yeah, it goes back to what we said on the first two drives for Minnesota. You got to make those catches if you're going to beat a team like Wisconsin. Even though they're tough, you got to come down with them. Instead, Minnesota's punting with 16 seconds remaining in the quarter. And you wonder how many possessions they'll get in the fourth quarter with the Wisconsin's dominant time of possession and the run game. Abradaris, look out, across midfield into Gopher territory. And he fumbles the ball. It's loose inside the 35. It's ugly under the pile in any game, even worse in a rivalry game. Cedric Thompson forced it out. I thought Wisconsin jumped on it first. That's what it looked like live.
And I thought Minnesota jumped on it first.
Well, again, who knows what's going on under that pile? It's Badger ball.
The ball has been on the ground a lot in this game. And again, it's because of how cold it is out. It's hard. And that's a great play by Thompson. It's hard to hold on to that thing when it's so cold out. And
We have an injury timeout.
And Cedric Thompson, who forced the fumble, shaken up on the play. He saw Gopher come flying in there to dive on it and try to get the fumble recovery. It was Jake Philkins, but Wisconsin able to come up with the fumble recovery. Looked like it was Leo Musso came up with a recovery. Badger ball when we start the fourth.
Wisconsin's won the last nine. Now, will the Gophers have a score to settle? Can the Badgers keep hold of Paul Bunyan's pride? Bunyan's axe has never been bigger. Chop that.
Nine-game win streak in the series for Wisconsin. Tied for the longest streak in the series. Minnesota won nine straight from 1933 to 1941. The Badgers have dominated time of possession. And this is the 34th snap on their last 39 plays run in Minnesota territory. Stavi in trouble, and his pass is incomplete. Tried to hit James White, who's back in the game. White was shaken up earlier with a left calf injury. Interesting decision there to come up throwing the ball.
It's an aggressive decision. They wanted to get the ball downfield on a crossing route, which is a big part of this Wisconsin offense. It's not all just James White and Melvin Gordon. And I think as you think about the confidence level of Wisconsin and Joe Stavi down the road, and this, they want to get him out outside, throw the ball a bit.
Here's Abrederas, so two straight pass plays. Abrederas inside the 30, and he stepped out at the 27-yard line, so it'll be short of the first down. And here comes a huge third down for Minnesota's defense. Remember, Jack Russell just missed a field goal, and they had trouble with the snap.
James White's coming back into the game here. Good to see that he's all right.
So third down and three for the Badgers.
And this is the area of the field and the down and distance where they love to get the ball to White from the screen game.
Abrederas was lined up in the backfield. Motioned out. And Stavi throwing. It's caught. Abrederas. Oh, what a tackle by Shabazz, keeping him short of the first down. It's fourth down and two. Let's see if the Badgers go for it here.
Great job by Shabazz. He's got him in man-to-man coverage. He doesn't bite on the inside route. Comes out, just gets enough of Abrederas and gets him on the ground to bring up a fourth down. Looks like Wisconsin is going to punt.
I'd go for it here.
Okay.
I'd go for it, get the first down. Field goal, yeah, I know it gets you to 16 points. They're setting up the fake formation here with Russell. It's Meyer throwing it back to Arneson. He's going to get tackled at the 34-yard line. Minnesota was all over that. So they had Meyer, the snapper, who's also the punter, throwing the ball, and Hageman was all over that play. And so the Gophers take over and have a little momentum now.
Well, they wanted Arneson to throw the ball down the field, but the receiver couldn't get out. The ball was going to be thrown down here after Arneson caught it. Let's take a look, but the receiver couldn't get out in the route. That was Wozniak that couldn't get out.
Why not just line up and pound the ball? They didn't run it once on that possession. Three pass play, four pass plays. And now it's Minnesota ball. Get close to all the action wherever you are with the new SportsCenter app. Blazing fast scores, the hottest news and highlights, and access to your favorite SportsCenter talent 24/7 via Twitter. You can download the new SportsCenter app by calling *SC from your phone. Early fourth quarter here in Minneapolis, and temperature's been steady since kickoff, 16 degrees. Feels like five.
Good night for chili.
Feels a little warmer in the booth than five. Not as much for our sideline analyst, Tom Luganville.
He'll be okay. He's strong.
And our camera crew, too. First down for Minnesota. And they run Donovan Jones on the jet sweep, and he does well to get back to the line of scrimmage, maybe get 1 yard. Let's go back to what Wisconsin did. Three pass plays, and then the fake field goal. What did you make of the decision?
Well, hard for me to know what Gary Anderson was thinking there. You could take some time off the clock early in the fourth quarter, up 13 points. but the fake field goal just, it looked like never had a chance to work. And you have a tight end throwing the ball and the protection. You couldn't get Hageman off, and then the guy couldn't get out. It just wasn't very well executed, one that I'm sure he would like to have back.
Nelson gonna throw it deep, and a leaping attempt. It's caught. Donovan Jones made a play at the 35-yard line of Wisconsin.
Senior receiver Derek Engel out of this game with a torn ACL. They're dependent on true freshman Donovan Jones. And in the fourth quarter of a 13-point game, somebody needs to make a play. And he goes up. Nelson gives him an opportunity, goes up and comes down with it. And we've seen how difficult it's been for everybody else on the field to come down with that kind of play. And Donovan Jones made it.
31 yards, their longest pass play of the day. Previous high was 9. Inside the Badger 40-yard line. Another pass play here. Nelson going deep again into the end zone. Knocked away by Shelton. Intended for Walatarski. Minnesota attacking the Badger secondary here on this drive.
Walatarski was open by a couple of yards, and you see the closing speed of true freshman Sojourn Shelton. You can't teach that. When you get, find out what route that receiver is running, and then you get that catch-up speed from the corner position, you've got something. And I know that Dave Aranda and Coach Anderson are really excited about this young player. They're going to build this defense around players like Shelton.
He's about 175 pounds, came to camp from Fort Lauderdale, Florida at 150 pounds. Here's Cobb, and the hole not there. Driven back, and they'll spot him at the 32-yard line, so a 3-yard pickup. It'll bring up third down and long. Tyler Dipple was in there first for Wisconsin.
And I like the aggressive play call on first down to throw the ball down the field for Matt Limegrover. Problem is now you bring up a 3rd and 7. I think Jerry Kill right now is looking over at Limegrover saying, hey, you got 4 downs here. And Tracy Clay is probably saying the same thing.
Kill is up in the press box for the fifth straight game, and he told us yesterday he'll often make the decision to go for it on fourth down, even though Tracy Clays is the acting head coach.
He sits right next to Matt Limegrover, and the communication is pretty quick.
3rd down and 6. Pressure coming. Nelson, and incomplete. Intended for Jones. Maybe mistimed his jump. Fourth down, and Minnesota's going to go for it here. Down 13 points. You have to with 11:27 left.
Yeah, and there's Coach Kill, and normally what he'll do is he'll make that signal on third down before that play goes, so that Limegrover's already trying to find his play that he likes for fourth down, so that they can communicate and get that call down to the field on Nelson as fast as possible.
So 4th down and 6.
Look for Max Williams in the slot, the tight end. He's right here.
Nelson overthrows Williams. He had him. Incomplete. He was open at the 10. Nelson knows he missed a chance. And Wisconsin takes over on downs.
They had exactly what they wanted. The play action sucked up the linebacker southward, number 12, and he's wide open. You just got to put that on him. He might score, and this would be a 6-point game, but they missed it.
ESPN College Football is presented by Cars.com. Get the right car without all the drama. Cars.com. All drive, no drama. And in part by the all-new 2014 Chevy Silverado.
Back here in Minneapolis, and that's the look on a lot of faces of Gopher fans after Minnesota with a missed opportunity. You had Max Williams wide open. Nelson could not hit him on fourth down, and the Badgers take over on downs. The defense has pitched a shutout. The only points for Minnesota came in an interception return for a touchdown, as Wisconsin keeps it on the ground, but White brought down for a loss back at the 30-yard line.
Let's go back to that fourth down. Here's Desmond Southward. He's going to be influenced by the run action here by Minnesota, and this is the opportunity right here that Philip Nelson has. You just got to put that ball on Max Williams. They got exactly what they wanted. They got the reaction from Southward, who had him in man coverage. And Philip Nelson, in a reoccurring theme for Minnesota today, so many missed opportunities that if you want to beat a team like Wisconsin, you got to make those plays.
The defense comes up with a 2-yard setback on first down. And now Gordon
Jackson spun down in the backfield inside the 25 by Roland Johnson. That's back-to-back plays by Johnson. Now you're in third down and close to 20, and you would imagine Wisconsin will throw the ball here. They were hoping just to be able to run the ball and put together a 6-7 minute drive like they did in the third quarter.
Well, think about the way that Minnesota defensively has played in this second half. I mean, they have been put in difficult situations, punt return, turnovers, and all they've done is come out and stop Wisconsin. We thought they'd come out and run the football all over them in the second half, and that hasn't happened.
Third down and 18. Wisconsin 2 of 12 on third down. And they're going to run it. Gordon across the 35. Did not get the first down, but they got a chunk of it back so they can flip the field here. And who knows? I mean, Gordon's yards per carry this year is 9 yards. If he breaks a tackle, he might have picked up the first down. So a punting situation here, but the clock is running. Drew Meyer will kick, and we've seen a lot of returnable punts, and Marcus Jones is a dangerous return man. He does have 2 returns for touchdowns, a kick return and a punt return this year.
Main thing is he's got to catch the ball first, right? With this weather, with the wind starting to pick up, you got to catch and secure the ball.
And it kicks out of bounds around the 33-yard line, so decent field position for Minnesota after only a 31-yard punt. This week on Countdown, former Patriots star Wes Welker sits with Teddy Bruschi to discuss his time in New England, his return to Foxborough this weekend, and the differences of playing with Tom Brady and Peyton Manning. And before you finalize your roster, join our experts in fantasy football now. Sunday NFL Countdown at 10 a.m. on ESPN. Fantasy football now, 11 a.m. on ESPN2.
Pretty lucky guy to play with Tom Brady and Peyton Manning.
A matchup Sunday night. Again, Broncos and Patriots. Minnesota still with a chance, 9 minutes to go. Two poor possessions by Wisconsin offensively, and now Nelson takes on a safety, Tanner McAvoy, and gets about 7 yards to the 41-yard line. Inside 9 to go, 20-7 Wisconsin. Ohio State is blowing at Indiana, so the Buckeyes are going to clinch. They're going to get their spot in the Big Ten championship game. Michigan State earned its spot earlier today, so both Minnesota and Wisconsin cannot make it to Indianapolis, but still trying to improve their bowl standing, and for Wisconsin, perhaps a BCS at large. They gave him 9 on the play, 2nd down and 1, and Cobb loses a yard to the 42. Brandon Kelly made the tackle, so now 3rd down coming up for Minnesota.
Man, this is the situation, 3rd and 2, 3rd and 3, where Matt Limegrover likes to use play action, and they're bringing Frick T into the game. And they're bringing their fullback, Mike Henry, out of the game. Anticipate some kind of play-action pass here. I don't think they can just line up and run the ball in between the tackles and get 3 yards.
They flex Max Williams out. He's in the slot to the bottom of your screen. That's where they went in the red zone on the last play of that last drive. It's a quarterback run, and Nelson is going to come up short, brought down by Ethan Armstrong. It's 4th and 1. You have to go for it here if you're Minnesota with 7:45 left, down 2 scores.
Yeah, and I think that's probably, Jerry Kill probably gave the signal to Limegrover, you got 4 downs, and that influenced the call on 3rd down, because I don't think you, if you knew you had to make that on 3rd down, run the ball with the quarterback there. I think you throw it, but now you can certainly get 1 yard run the football.
Well, they try to run on 2nd and 1. Earlier in the series and lost yardage, so let's see what they do. 4th down and 1. This is it here for the Gophers, you would think, if they don't pick it up. Minnesota's been pretty good on 4th down this year. It's Cobb, and he appears to have it as he extends to the 45-yard line. They had 2 officials trying to get together and where to spot it, and it is a 1st down. 7 minutes remaining in the fourth. A fresh set of downs for the Gophers. They trail by 13. They have not scored a point on offense today, and now they have to come up with at least 13 in 7 minutes.
Well, now you got to start thinking about taking a shot. Your 2 playmakers downfield are Donovan Jones and Max Williams. They're both in the game right now, flexed out at wide receiver. You got to get some chunk yardage if you're Minnesota.
Wisconsin didn't allow a touchdown last week. They have not given up an offensive touchdown today. Nelson going to go downfield, going for Frickte. One-handed try, but he can't come up with it. Hillary and Shelton were down there for Wisconsin, but it's incomplete.
Really wanted to take the shot. They said, the coaches said that Frickte was going to take the place of Engel in these situations. This is typically where Engel would make these plays. He's a little bit faster. Frickte just out of his reach to make that play.
So you threw it downfield on first down. You still have the option here to run the ball, or there's just not enough time for you.
You need some chunk yardage because you need two scores. Only 6.5 minutes left in this game.
Passing formation here. Nelson pumps. Now throws it to the sideline, and oh, incomplete again. Max Williams thought he had it. He also thought he was interfered with. Boy, Williams has had plenty of opportunities to make catches to help out his quarterback today.
Well, he's got to get two hands up. He's holding the arm there. That was a pass interference by Nate Hammond, the safety. There it is right there. He's holding on to his arm twice. He does it, and the officials missed it.
He still almost caught it with one hand.
Well, the side judge there was blocked by Williams' body, and so he probably didn't see that, and sometimes that's coached for those defensive backs to get that arm out there, but that's very clearly pass interference.
Well, now you're four down territory, so let's see how they handle this third down here. Is another pass play. They try to get some yardage on the ground. Now Nelson looking to throw, and Williams, and now the flag comes in, and Williams caught it. It didn't matter that Caputo interfered. Williams said, I'm tired of getting close. I got to secure one of these. Help my team, and he did that time at the 33-yard line.
Well, give Max Williams credit. He didn't spend time arguing with the officials. He just went back and made the play.
Defense, number 7. Penalties declined. Result of the play is the first down.
But it's the same route, same play, and same thing happens. He got his hand on Williams.
Great catch.
Great catch by Williams. If I'm Minnesota, I'm coming right back to it. If I get man-to-man coverage, Max Williams on a linebacker or a safety, I'm taking more shots down the field.
Minnesota has not crossed the Wisconsin 30-yard line all game. They're at the 33, first down. They go to that stack formation, and now a timeout called by Minnesota with a play clock at 6. That could be a costly timeout here. Now you're down to 2 timeouts. You need those. With only 6 minutes remaining in the game, down 2 scores. But they burn one here. And we'll be back to Minneapolis in a moment.
Time for a Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. The ACC Wheel of Destiny is spinning. Boston College down 24-20 to Maryland. Here's Chase Reddick finding a man wide open. Alex Amadon would score, but Maryland blocked the extra point. Anthony Nixon took it back for the 2, so we're tied at 26, 5 and change to go.
Reese, enjoy that fire there in the studio with Mark and Lou and the marshmallows.
Oh, yeah, they got pizza there. They got all those screens set up. That's, you know, there's no better place in the world to watch college football than that studio.
6 minutes to go. Minnesota with a first down at the Wisconsin 33. Down 20-7. Play action pass. Nelson with time going again for Max Williams, who had to adjust to the ball. And another interference call. This one on Nate Hammond. Well, it's like you said, Max Williams had to leave the game. Probably tired. They call a timeout, get him back out there, and they go at him on the first play.
Just keep throwing it to him. Right now, the best offense for Minnesota is the yellow hanky.
15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
And this ball's not even anywhere near where Max Williams can catch it, but you fight back for the ball, and you get the extension on Hammond. Hammond's overmatched right now. Hammond is only 196 pounds, and Max Williams is 254 pounds. If you're Wisconsin, stop playing man-to-man coverage. Play zone, keep the eyes to the quarterback, and you can eliminate these pass interference calls.
They're inside the Wisconsin 20 for the first time on offense. Nelson on the rollout, looking to throw it back, and Frickte. Oh, what a
play broken up at the last second by McAvoy. Incomplete. Frichte was settling in, thought he was going to have a touchdown catch, but McAvoy was there for the Badgers.
It was a well-designed play, and at the last minute, great play and effort by McAvoy. That ball kind of got caught up, and Philip Nelson is throwing back into that wind, and it's hard to drive that ball in a cold wind, and it just hung up and inches from being a touchdown.
Mad with himself. He's had an overthrow and an underthrow here in the fourth quarter. Had both been thrown accurately, they would have been touchdowns. They'll throw it to the flat here to KJ May, and he's got nowhere to go. Pinballs to the 19-yard line, so maybe got back to the line of scrimmage. Well, that's third and long.
We're talking about accurate throws for Philip Nelson. You have to mention they probably can't feel his hand either. You know, I've been down there in that situation, and to sit up here and to say this ball should be thrown this way or that way, it's hard when you can't feel your fingertips to get an accurate spin and an accurate throw on that ball. It's just very difficult.
See him put it in the hand warmer there before he gets the shotgun snap. 10th play of the drive, third down and 10, four down territory for Minnesota as we hit the 5-minute mark. Nelson going to the end zone, incomplete. Intended for Donovan Jones. Darius Hillary on the coverage. Fourth down and 10, Minnesota will go for it.
I think here you got to try to find flex out Max Williams and Jones again, although Max Williams is coming out of the ball game. I'm not sure why he would come out of the ball game in the biggest play of the game for Minnesota. Unless you have some kind of trick play dialed up here. They brought in Goodger. Donovan Jones in the game, May and Frichte, and Goodger the tight end.
Yeah, Goodger more of a blocking tight end. Fourth down and 10. Rolling out Nelson, trying to throw it back to Cobb. And that play had no chance. He caught it, but tackled by Chris Borland, and Wisconsin takes over on downs.
I think that's exactly what happened. They had the trick play, the throwback play, which is run out of a certain personnel group, and Chris Borland was not fooled. There he is. Take a look. They're just going to try to throw it back, but you're not going to fool one of the smartest players in college football. He's all over it, and one-on-one in the open field, he's not missing that tackle.
12 tackles for Borland, two fumble recoveries, and his 14th career forced fumble, number one among active FBS players, and ties the FBS record along with five others with those 14 career forced fumbles. Forced a fumble and recovered a fumble on the same play, taking down the running back Cobb earlier as White gets to the 18-yard line. Minnesota can only stop the clock twice. They are warming the axe. They're keeping it warm for the players. Either that or it's in hiding, one or the other. As we're 4.5 minutes away from, it appears, Wisconsin keeping Paul Bunyan's axe for the 10th straight year and getting their 9th win overall, going to 6-1 in the Big Ten, and a chance to move up in the BCS standings and try to get in play for an at-large BCS game.
And Minnesota looks back on this game. If they end up losing, it will be the missed opportunities, the turnovers, and some of the drop passes and missed throws on offense that will really haunt them. The defense played well enough to win.
White up to the 19-yard line, so only a gain of one, and Minnesota's going to use a timeout here. So third down coming up. Wisconsin's last game of the season is at home against Penn State. Coming up tonight, Saturday Night Football presented by Windows. On ABC, it's Baylor and Oklahoma State. The winner of this game controls its own destiny for the Big 12 championship. And if Baylor wins, and depending on the score, with all the eyeballs watching tonight, could impact where they are in the BCS standings when the latest edition is announced tomorrow night.
Baylor wins, they're going to jump Ohio State, and they're not going to look back. And the other thing that happens if Baylor wins that game, you know, we don't know what's going to happen with Jameis Winston and Florida State. I'm not quite sure what's happening with LSU and A&M and Johnny Manziel for the Heisman Trophy, but Bryce Petty, in my opinion, deserves to be in New York. And if he can win against Oklahoma State and win out TCU, Texas. He deserves to be there and be a part of that conversation.
Third down and four. Big play here for Minnesota if it wants to have any shot in this ball game. Stavi. It's caught by Pettersson, and he has enough to move the chains based on where they spot it at the 24-yard line. It's a first down for Wisconsin. Well, and for Johnny Manziel, he won it last year. We know that only one guy's won it twice as they get the axe prepared. And, you know, the other thing, too, is if Baylor is undefeated, a lot of times you see players get a Heisman Trophy based on team, even though they have a great year. It may not, and he's got great numbers, obviously. I think it's going to be tough for Manziel to win it again, I guess is what I'm saying.
Oh,
just
really?
Because of the losses, even though he has the numbers, but the record.
Well, I think despite the losses, I know there are losses on their stat sheet, but everybody knows the way he played in those games, right? Against Auburn and Alabama, two of the best teams in the SEC, and how what his performance was in those games is undisputed. If he's able to win on the road in one of the most difficult places to play tonight, or today at LSU, and again, I don't know where that game is, but and then beat Missouri next week, then I think it's his to lose.
I think if Florida State goes undefeated and whatever happens with Jameis Winston, whatever the ruling is about him, whether there's charges or not, does not come until after the voting is done, I think people will vote for him number one.
Oh, I think those, I mean, we're going to know a lot more before December 8th.
Here's Gordon short of the first down. We'll see if Minnesota uses its final timeout, and they will here.
With Jameis Winston, the latest is anticipated some kind of a ruling on the charging or no charging next week or the following week. And if he's charged, forget about conviction and all that. If he's charged, then he will be suspended from what we understand of the FSU policy outside of one loophole. But if he's charged and suspended, then there's no way that he can win the Heisman Trophy. So I think we will have a lot more information in the next couple of weeks.
Let's wait on that and let's see what happens before we go there, because I know a lot of people are talking about, oh, how would you vote if you don't know the outcome? You know, does that impact how you vote for Jameis Winston and how you vote for Florida State when you're talking about the BCS standings? But for what you were saying earlier about Baylor, you know, to win tonight at Oklahoma State, it's a team that has never won on the road. And you've got Art Briles, who's turned this program around. But to get over the hump, to take that next step, I think you have to win a game like this.
Oh, absolutely. I don't think there's any question. And I think when we talk about, you know, the top coaching jobs in college football this year, Art Briles is right there in that conversation.
Gordon gets the first down, and Wisconsin now with 2:23 remaining, Minnesota unable to stop the clock, can just run it out here over the next three plays.
And quite frankly, I think both the coaches in this game should be in that conversation. Certainly Jerry Kill and Tracy Clays and the staff at Minnesota, what they have done this year, it doesn't look like they're going to win this game, but what they have done this year, going from a 6-7 team a year ago to 8-2 coming into this game, to beating Nebraska and Northwestern, Penn State, they need to be in the conversation for the Coach of the Year award. And I think Gary Anderson, I know they lost to Ohio State on the road, but that game against Arizona State, they should have won that game. A 30-yard chip shot, you can't hold that against them. I think that staff and Gary Anderson need to be in the conversation as well.
Think of what not only that game did for Wisconsin, because it obviously hurts them, because they'd be probably in the top 12 right now with just one loss. It hurts Ohio State. It hurts the perception of the entire Big Ten, because you've got an Arizona State team that if it wins today at UCLA, the Sun Devils are in the Pac-12 championship game.
And Wisconsin would be probably around 10, 11, 12, maybe in the BCS standings. And you're right, the perception of the Big Ten would be a little bit different, having Ohio State, Michigan State, and Wisconsin in the top 15 in the country. But that's how it goes sometimes.
You were asking earlier about A&M. They're down to LSU 31-10 in the fourth quarter.
Oh, well, there goes my my Johnny Manziel equation.
What a win for Wisconsin. 9-2, 6-1 with a new staff. And the defense for the second straight week does not allow a touchdown. Only 3 points given up last week against Indiana. And this week, the only points scored by Minnesota were on an Aaron Hill interception for a touchdown. And
Look at big Bo Allen, number 96 there, 325 pounds. He's going to be the first one to pick up that axe.
He should with that look.
Yeah, jeez. And the tradition is you go down to the field, to the goalpost, and start to chop down the goalpost. We'll see if that's what big man does.
Here comes the last snap. And Wisconsin beats Minnesota 20-7. And the axe remains in the Badgers' possession.
That's a great feeling right there. That's what's great about college football. You don't see this in professional football, these kinds of things, but especially for the seniors. And those are all seniors with their hands on that axe. And now they're going to take it over. There they run over to the field goal post and chop it down, big man, one time.
Bill Walton will love you after that. Let's go to Tom down on the field.
Coach, this is a great opportunity for you as a first-year head coach to take part in your first win for the Axe. What's that mean to you?
It's a tremendous win for the programs, for the kids. It's a hard-fought football game. That's a good football team. Minnesota, they're 8-2 for a reason before today. There's no question about it. But, we're very happy to get the win, grateful to get the win. These kids played like crazy all day long.
Your program's been defined by toughness. Coming into an environment like this, these type of elements, how does that make you feel about how your team performed today? Because it wasn't easy.
No, it wasn't. And they are tough. They're resilient. Both these teams are tough-minded. It's Big Ten football. That's what it's all about at the end. And they all left it out there. They competed like crazy. We made fortunate to make enough plays to be able to win the football game. But I'm very proud of these kids. They are a tough-minded crew.
Go grab that axe.
Oh, I will. Thanks.
All right, Coach.
So the Badgers improved to 9-2, 6-1. In the Big Ten, they've got Penn State next week. We'll see where they finish in the BCS standings and whether they get a BCS at large when it's all said and done. Minnesota has Michigan State next week. Still the first 8-win season for the Gophers since 2003, even though they come up short today against Wisconsin 20-7. So long from Minneapolis. College football scoreboard is coming up.